Lord, we pray now in Jesus' name that if anyone's discouraged, that they'd get out of that demonic realm. Step over here into the encouraged. Hallelujah. Where you moving in the hope? Where you ministering, God? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Arabotaranea pakaya. Anyone who's in fear, they leave that and come on over into love. Anyone who's in doubt, come on over into faith. Anyone who's all wrapped up in their self-will, come on over here into the Father's will. Anybody who's wrapped up in their own visions, come over into a heavenly vision. People, you decide. You can be stuck with your own ideas, your own life, or you can come on over here into this wonderful thing that Jesus Christ did for us. You can be stuck in the ideas of religion and self-interest and all the notions that come along with that. Or I can come into the glorious liberty of the sons of God and all that matters to Jesus. And all that you want to do is Father's will. And you're not interested in dictating to God anymore how he's going to use you. What he's going to do through you. We get excited about what he said is available for you. Begin to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Which is the expression, you know what righteousness is? Expressions of the Holy Ghost. Paul said in Galatians chapter 3, verse 21, he said, if there had been a law that could impart life, God's life, the life of the Spirit, the life of Jesus Christ, eternal life. It is a quality of life more than just an expression of quantity of life. He said this, very simple. If there had been a law that could have imparted life, then righteousness would have been by the law. All the law could do is condemn men that they had left the life of God and had stepped over into darkness. Jesus Christ says, behold, I am the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He comes to give us his abundant life, the life of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And then you've got everything. And then you don't have any reason to be sad ever again. That's why Mike's happy every time I see him. Find me a guy who's happy all the time. Every time I see him, I'll show you somebody you can trust with the things of the Spirit. That's true. It's true. And then for the rest of you, let me just tell you right now, God's just trying to get you happy. He's trying to be able to get you happy all the time, then he can trust you with more. How do you like that? Huh? How do you like that? Pretty easy? Can you quantify it now? Can you understand the goal you should be setting for your life? Huh? Look in the mirror. Understand why God can't use you anymore than he is. Just look in the mirror. See how happy you are, okay? When's the time you had the greatest impact on people around you? When you feel the joy. I'm answering your question for you. Am I right? I'm right. Amen. You didn't have to say anything. Amen. It's true. So we pray tonight that you guys just get so blessed. You just get so blessed with Jesus. I bet I was so blessed with the Lord Jesus Christ, I don't need anything more. Some people still running after this thing, that thing, the other thing. They need the praises of men. They want position, whatever else. I don't need anything. I got Jesus. I'm here tonight by divine dictate. I'm here by divine mandate. That's it. I'm his. I'm ready to go to Kashmir. We got it all set up. I'm ready to go to Kashmir. But I'm here by divine mandate here tonight. There's 3 billion people never heard had a chance to hear about Jesus one time. I'm interested, you know, going giving them an opportunity. Because I have everything I need. I'm already fit for heaven. So I said, if you go to Kashmir, you're going to die. Promotion. I have no earthly interest but to do the will of the Father. I've got one desire. Listen, dear people, I want you to know something tonight. We're getting ready to start worshiping. I want you to understand. Within 100 years, almost everybody in this place will break through the barrier. Within 100 years, you will break through the barrier. That's a very short period of time. You will have a great breakthrough where you will step from this world into the next. You will no longer have a veil between you and him. I hope tonight you get prepared. I hope tonight you set everything else aside. All that really should matter to you tonight is what's going to matter at that moment. That's it. Anything else, the distractions and nonsense. Just things to trick you, trip you up. It's a snare around your feet. Possibly even around a noose around your neck. Could be. Just understand where you're going. We're on a journey to somewhere glorious. Just right up ahead. Yes. It's right ahead, not too far. I can already see the lights of the celestial city. Somebody said, well, what is heaven to you? Heaven is the Garden of Eden with Christ Jesus there and all the saints gathered around. Yes, it is. It's the beauty of what God created in Genesis 1 and 2. Hallelujah. With nothing but the people of the Spirit. Hallelujah. But flowing in a greater dimension of the Holy Ghost that we can't even begin to relate to tonight. Most people, I've discovered that over and again, that so many people have never really come to realize how beautiful it is to live in the Holy Ghost. You've had an introduction. Most of you have had an introduction. Those of you here tonight, some of you watching by web, where the joys come on you, the glories overwhelm you. But you need it deeper. Because when it happens deeper in your life, you'll understand that you're supposed to live there all the time. You won't let anything keep you out of it. That's right. Once you step in the abundant life, you're not going to be back and forth between your life and his life anymore. Perplexed, overwhelmed, distracted, disoriented with all the other meaningless nonsense. Come on, people. Father's eyes go to and fro right now. He's looking for some people whom he can show himself mighty on their behalf. These are the days of the great outpourings of the Holy Ghost. I made up my mind a long time ago, I'll be in this by God's grace and by his mercy, which I have determined to be always in the center of the outpourings of God, the center of what he's about to do. And so, I mean, I'm just believing. People say, what about this and that thing? Man, I just hope all of ISIS comes over here. I hope, let us be a nation of refuge, because God's going to pour out his Holy Ghost and they're all going to get saved. They're all going to be born again, filled with the Spirit. See, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. People were all perplexed about things. Don't be anymore. Get introduced to the Holy Ghost. If you've been introduced to the Holy Ghost, understand he wants to live and abide in you. Understand he wants to fill you all the time. The joy unspeakable and full of glory is not just for a moment in time. Well, I had joy. I remember I had joy. It was amazing. It happened about 5 years ago. That was just a handshake. That was just hello. That was just God saying hello. And it's just God saying, Father saying to you and to me, I have an invitation here for you to come live and abide in my presence all the time. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Well, are you ready to ascend? Are you ready to ascend? Who shall ascend into the heel of the Lord? Those who have clean hands and a pure heart. Have no wrong intentions in the heart. They're just consecrated, committed it. Let Father have his way. Tonight, will you take your whole life, be willing to place it upon the altar? Would you do that tonight, every one of you? Would you place your life upon the altar? All your wills and all your wishes and all your ideas and all the things that you think it's got to be that way, otherwise it ain't right. Could you just go ahead and place it upon the altar so God, Father, can show you what really is right? What you really should have, what you really should be doing. Would you let Father correct you tonight? Would you let him instruct you in the ways of life? Would you let him come lead you? Let him come guide you? Would you let him open up his word to you and show you wondrous things out of his word that you have not known? Huh? Anybody?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes, Lord.
Yes.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Tonight, just let the weak say I'm strong. Let the poor say I'm rich. Let the sick say I'm healed. Amen. Let the discouraged, if there is such of a thing, say I've received great things in God. I'm doing great things in God. Amen. Hallelujah. Mambra sati di kito lo mosikita kana makaya kitea tusi. Libera se per mando le defichia. Erre vivete si shila. Bella la mondo makateri babasiti in la la mondo di eta la mosi. Ti bene bashikaro mama mama la 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 la
la. How precious are your thoughts towards me. How great is the sum of them. precious. How precious are your thoughts toward me. Lord, how precious are your thoughts toward me.
How great.
Serve you all my day, Lord.
Put your goodness and your mercy surround me. Put your goodness and your mercy surround me. Put your goodness and your mercy surround me.
No greater goodness, no greater mercy.
Your goodness and your mercy surround me. Your goodness and your mercy surround me. Your goodness and your mercy surround me.
Lord, your goodness and your mercy surround me. Oh, you surround me. Oh, your goodness and your mercy surround me. Your goodness and your mercy surround me. But your goodness and your mercy surround me. But your goodness and your mercy surround me. But your goodness and your mercy surround me. Put your goodness and your mercy surround me. So I will worship you, Lord. I will worship you with all my breath, my being. I will worship you, Lord. I will worship you, Lord. For your goodness and your goodness and your mercy surround me. Would your goodness and your mercy surround me? Would your goodness and your mercy surround me? So I will serve you all my days. I will serve you all my days. I will serve you all my days. I will serve you all my days, Lord. I will serve you all my days. I will serve you all my days. Mercy you've extended unto me. Oh, what marvelous mercy has been extended unto me. Oh, what marvelous mercy has been extended unto me. Oh, what marvelous mercy has been extended unto me. Mercy has been extended unto me. Oh, what marvelous mercy has been extended unto me. Love divine, oh, love divine, oh, love divine, oh, love divine. Oh, goodness and your mercy surround me. your goodness and your mercy surround me.
Lord
Jesus. Your goodness and your mercy surround me.
Lord
Jesus. Your goodness and your mercy surround me. Your goodness and your mercy surround me.
Lord Jesus, Mom, Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus.
So I will serve, oh, I will serve you all my day. Your goodness and your mercy surround me. 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 Your goodness and your mercy surround me.
Jesus, Lord Jesus, Jesus, Lord, we worship you, Lord, we adore you, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus, Lord, Jesus, Savior, Jesus, my God forever. Lord Jesus, I worship you. Lord, I worship you. I worship you. I yield my life to you, oh God, we worship you. We bow our lives before you now, we worship you, Jesus. Healer of my body.
You need to be healed just let the anointing of the Holy Ghost begin to flow through you as you worship Him. I mean, begin to worship and praise until heaven raptures you. That's where healing's at. You have a need, you have a trouble. Just begin to worship Him and praise Him until the glory raptures you.
Be caught away in the glory. Be caught away in His presence. Let the glory of the Lord overwhelm your lives right now. Oh, glory of the Lord, overwhelm my life right now. Like the water that covers the sea. Oh God, surround me. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus.
You, Lord. You, Father God. Father, we thank you for breaking off every yoke, Lord. Thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Spirit that destroys every yoke. Thank you, Father, for the well springs, oh God. Thank you for the rivers, Father. Thank you, Father, for your glory and for your presence, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Take full control, God. Have your way in me. Take full control, oh God. Have your way in me. Take full control, oh God. I yield myself to thee. I yield myself to thee. Take full control, oh God.
Teach me to yield to you, Lord.
Teach me to yield to you, Lord. Let your glory be revealed. Let Jesus be revealed. Through my life. oh God. Through our lives, oh God. Through your church, Lord Jesus. It's your church, Lord Jesus. Doesn't belong to men. It's your church, Lord Jesus. Be glorified.
Jesus. In your mercy rushes over me. Your mercy rushes over me. In your love fills my being, Lord. Your love fills my being. Your mercy rushes over me. But your mercy rushes over me. A fire burning me. consuming fire burning me. Oh, a consuming fire burning me. Oh, burn, burn, burn in my soul. Burn, burn, burn in my soul. But your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain. But your presence is like fire, it's like water, like the floods of rain, Jesus. Nothing as precious as your presence, Lord. Your presence is life. Your presence is life. A presence, a consuming fire. Burn, burn, burn here, burn here.
Consuming fire.
A consuming fire. Our God is 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 a consuming fire.
Our God is
a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire.
Sing in the spirit, oh, sing in the understanding too. Let the river of God, though the rivers of expression express through you, go so rabavido, sabravekis telepum ravero, go si remana la mongerave, kusabribabos mane. Take your sovereign power, oh God. Take your sovereign power, Lord, come rule. Take your sovereign power, God. Oh, take your sovereign power, come rule. Come and rule, Lord Jesus Christ. Come take your power now. Come rule, come reign. Oh, come rule. Lord Jesus, come rule, come reign, come take your sovereign power, oh God. Come take your power and reign, take your sovereign power, oh Lord. Come rule, come reign, come rule, come reign, come rule, come reign, oh Jesus Christ, Lord, Lord Jesus. Lord, Lord Jesus, Lord, come take your power and reign. Come take your power and reign. Oh, Lord Jesus, come take your power and reign. Oh, reign over me. Tonight, come on, reign over me right now. Jesus Christ, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, take your power and reign, come reign. Sovereign Lord, come reign over me.
Come on, come on,
come reign over me, Lord Jesus. Come reign over me tonight. Come reign over me, Lord Jesus. Come reign over me the rest of my life. Come reign over me, Lord Jesus,
Come reign over me tonight. Come reign over me, Lord Jesus. Come reign over me the rest of my life. Come reign over me, Lord Jesus. Come reign over me tonight. Come reign over me, Lord Jesus. Come reign over me tonight. Come reign over me, Lord Jesus. Take your power, come and reign. Take your power, come and reign. Take your power, come and reign. Come on now. No, you come on now. Take your power, come and reign. Lord Jesus, take your power, come and reign. Come tell him, take your power, come and reign. Come reign, come reign, come reign, come reign. Take your power and come and reign. Take your power, come and reign. Lord Jesus, come tonight. Take your power, come and reign. Come and rule with our soul. Take your power, come and reign. Come reign over us. Take your power, come and reign. Come and reign here tonight. Take your power, come and reign. Lord Jesus Christ, take your power, come and reign. Come reign here tonight. Woo-hoo! Every force of hell, everything that would stand in the way, take your power, Lord Jesus. Come and reign in this place tonight. Take your power, Lord Jesus. Come and make this place tonight. With the force of heaven, God, take this place called Southern California, called the U.S. of America, called the nations of the world. Jesus, come and reign. Take your sovereign power, come and reign. Come on. Take your sovereign power, come and reign. Take your sovereign power, come and reign. Take your sovereign power, come and reign. Come rain, the rest of my life, come rain. Come and rain here tonight. For the rest of my life, Lord, rain.
Come and rain.
Take your power, come and rain. Rain, Lord. Take your power, Jesus Christ, Savior. Let your glory fill the earth like the water that covers the sea. Let your glory fill the earth like the shining of the sun at noonday. Take your sovereign power, O God. Come reign over me. We yield to you, Jesus. We yield to you, Lord Jesus. We yield to you, O God. Let your glory be revealed, O God. That plan that you designed, the desire of your heart, O God, we pray.
way tonight. Holy Spirit, take control. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus. Let the sovereign reign of God's divine glory fill this place tonight. Fill my life tonight. Fill me, Lord. Oh, continually fill me, Lord. Sing it with me. Oh, fill me, Lord. Continually fill me, Lord. Oh, fill me, Lord. Oh, continually fill me, Lord. Fill me, Lord. Continually fill me, Lord. Fill me here tonight. Just tell him, fill me here tonight. Fill me. I'm going to tell you, there's people standing in here. You need a touch from heaven. You need to know what it's like to have the glory of heaven surging through your life. But there's hindrances in the way. There's problems. There's things that stand between you and Jesus. So tonight, I just want you to imagine yourself that you're the woman with the issue of blood. And you've spent all of your money and you've only gotten worse. And the obstacles are so great, there's absolutely no way possible, really, for you to get at Jesus. The crowd is moving too swiftly. It's too thick to penetrate anyways. And your need seems so small in the huge throng of humanity. In the huge issues of your life. The question is, how desperate are you, and are you willing to press in? Are you willing to move past the problem? Because there's many people, they by their own choice allow themselves to continually be the prisoner to their problems. I'm going to tell you, listen to me right now. Christ Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's here right now, and his promise is anyone who calls upon his name, he will deliver them from their problems. And you might say, well, I called upon his name. Well, you obviously need to call a little bit louder. You say, well, I believe God. Well, you obviously need to be willing to believe a little bit more. I want you to understand, Father, not only provided for us all the solutions to our problems and our issues, but he provided for us the Holy Spirit to be able to begin to move through our emotions and our passions and our desires and motivate us. Yes. The only difference between you and me is I won't let Satan or problems or issues hinder me. If there's any difference, that would be it. The only difference between you and anybody who's ever lived and known God in a greater way than you know him tonight, is that they would not allow anything to stand between themselves and all that Father promised. They make God's word superior to all things. Now, I want you to let the heavenly emotions begin to touch you. Listen. You'd like to mature in God. You don't want to mature in God as much as God wants you to mature. You've got to get out of lockdown. And you know, you say, what do you mean? I'm telling you, you're going to have to learn how to understand that there are things that come out against you in the realms
of the satanic, in the realms of your own emotions, in the realms of your own issues. Come on now. Come on now. Listen, if there's any time that you ever want to just begin to be caught away and understand how to be caught away. Listen, there's a lot of people been prayed for. They didn't get healed because they don't know how to flow in the anointing. I live in a realm of no sickness and no disease simply because anytime sickness comes on me, I know how to touch heaven because I touch heaven all the time. And I plead with people, listen, your bondage, your issues, your problems are easily remedied. All you have to do is touch heaven. The riches of heaven are supplying for you here tonight. Yeah. Come on, man. Don't stand there like that, looking at me like that. No, listen. You are here in this place to be taught of the Holy Spirit how to receive that which he calls abundant life. So just begin the mosikanine. Just begin to rejoice. Listen, look here. I don't believe that you can rejoice with a frown on your face. I don't believe it. And there's so much smile and happy here. And all you gotta do is quit being wrapped up in whatever it is you're wrapped up in. One day giving yourself to sadness will ensure that 100 days will follow. It'll ensure that a stronghold will be able to take your hold of your life. To begin to understand where the battle really is. You know, what things there are that are coming out in your life against you to affect you. And then understand what that effect is. And if you could just recognize and one of the biggest things that the powers of darkness wants to do is shut down ecstatic praise and distract you with all kinds of things in the meeting. Come on. We even teach their children at a very young age how to bring their baby dolls to church, how to bring their snacks to church, huh? How to have all these distractions and all these other things going on. Are you listening to me? Come on, people. Take it higher. Don't you even understand what's going on? Do you know what's happening? You don't know what's happening, do you? How many of you really realize what's happening right now? Probably not many of you really understand what's going on. How that the enemy comes to do everything he can stop that glorious anointing and that glorious flow of the Holy Ghost. How that Father allows it simply so that you and I can step up and put every power of darkness, every stronghold, everything that the enemy tries to do in his proper place. Yeah? Yeah. So you want to grow and so you want to mature, huh? You know where the big battle is? Whether or not you're going to stay happy. That's where the big battle is. You can measure the whole of the response to the battle, the whole growth and maturity in your life about how the joy in the Holy Ghost is able to flow through your life. See, the kingdom of God's not in all the things that we make it to be. Paul said the kingdom of God's not in all the things that we make it to be. Romans 14:17. He said the kingdom of God is in righteousness and joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Ghost.
In the Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, mighty God. No, no, no. Let's leave us alone. We want to have a little religious service and then go on to do our own thing and live our whole lives fully for ourselves. And pretend we're serving God, doing it for him. No, I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm not going to let you have such a... I want to see you get caught away in glory. I want to see you be able to eat. The anointing of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Lord, is so easy to yield to. And the response is already written. It's written. The response is the same for every person. The response is the glory of heaven, the joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. this among us. When the monkey reshikando the potaya. Les Brahman today. Inamongsiya. Now, listen to what the Spirit of the Lord says. The enemy of your soul, the enemy of the faith, and the enemy of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ comes out to stop people on an individual basis so that they can't move forward. And then, if you're willing to obey God and quit just letting things be, you know, whatever the circumstances and the situations and your feelings dictate, but you begin to submit yourself to the Word of God and you stir up holy emotions and you demand of yourself to be that which God described for you to be, then the enemy will come out and try to resist you so that you cannot connect with the church, the body of Christ. Because see, God, the Holy Spirit, supplying something. Listen, I'm talking to you tonight. Let me tell you, there's some of you here tonight, you should have grown past those expressions you had 20 years ago. Come on. Listen, the expression that you worship and you praise, it should be something that causes the atmosphere to be supercharged with the glory of the Lord, not aggravating, not disrupting, not like what's happening now. Listen, and let me just tell you why. Because there comes a time, there was a time where it was beautiful, right? It was a time when the baby crying, it wasn't so bad, it's baby crying, right? But then it gets obnoxious after 20 years kind of thing. I'm just giving an example. Don't say, oh, he's talking about me, I was 20 years ago. But I'm trying to help you understand how to move past the stuff that's going on in your life. You just have to, if you want deeper in God, you got to be hungry and thirsty for deeper in God, because it's not going to come just passively. Because these things are sacred. The church of the Lord Jesus Christ belongs to Him. It's His. The place is sacred. It isn't for man. It's not about man. You and I have no rights to touch it with our own opinions and with our own ideas and with our own wishes and with our own wants. It's the worst iniquity that could possibly be expressed. So far as I'm concerned, it's worse than adultery. This belongs to Jesus Christ. And Father has said, He's calling and giving us an invitation for every one of us to be able to grow up into Him, to grow up into Him who is dead, Christ Jesus. And this is His command. He orders your greatness. He elected and commanded your greatness. You need to learn how to dance more. You stand still too long. You look too awkward in your sedate kind of state. Are you listening to me? You've been fashioned and conformed to a world that is without God, without Christ. And you don't want to look nothing like them. You want to find somebody who's as full of the Holy Ghost as you possibly could imagine they could get and act just like them. Hallelujah. You want to look and act like Jesus. You want to look and act like the Apostle Paul. Hallelujah. You know, the Apostle Paul, he said, his description of himself is he was beside himself. He was only sober so that he could communicate the gospel. When he writes the great theme, the great chapter, the great commission of the expressions of the Holy Ghost in the language, he said, I would that you would all speak with the heavenly language. He said, I speak in the heavenly language more than all of you. Verse 6, verse 17. And then he says, forbid not to speak with the heavenly language. Then all of the naysayers and all the anointing fighters come along and say something totally different that Paul never said and tried to use the chapter 14 that he preached. Of course, my goodness, they don't have any other expressions of the glory of God in their life. But reality of it is, I'm talking about the expressions of God's glory in your life and how you're allowing them to mature. I don't believe, and I'm going to say this, I'm saying it in the first person. I say, I'm not interested. I'm saying the first person on His behalf. God's not, and I'm going to say it in a way we'll make it more acceptable maybe to you. God's not interested in your signs, wonders, your miracles, and your great deeds. He's interested in your loves, your hugs, and your worship. He's interested in your excitement about who He is. No, you listen to me. God the Holy Ghost has come to reveal what great things God has done for you. To know and believe the love that God has for you sets you into a whole other category. To know and believe the love that God has for you. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is your love made perfect. My wife said to me today, she said, honey, you've been quoting quite a lot lately, 1 John 4:15. How about 1 John 2:5? They that keep his commandments dwell in God, and he dwells in them. Hallelujah. Herein is how your love is made perfect. And it's true, because the Word of God is going to teach you about all God's love for you, and the Holy Ghost can come and reveal all God's love for you, and you're going to get excited, and you're going to start jumping around. Listen to me. I want you to listen to me. There have been times where I've been sick and where I've been hurting and where I've been weary and where I've been tired. There have been times where there has been the discouragement. I mean, whole troops of hell, discouragement come out against me. And if I would have let them, those things would have been able to affect me. I don't let them. Jesus is bigger than those things to me. Huh? I don't let anything mess with me. Somebody said, oh, my heart was hurting me. And I was feeling kind of grieved inside. I know how to shout the grief away. Hallelujah. I know how to praise God to all the problems and the issues. I know how to go around the hindering wall of circumstance until the thing collapses, until a shout comes forth. Come on now. Sometimes I hear people praying and it's just horrific. It's like, ah! It's like they're screaming at God. You're not going to get anywhere like that. Anything that's spiritual. You ain't getting anywhere like that. You have to learn how to enjoy his presence. Instead of enjoying his presence, that you begin to hear him speak. If there's anything worship and praise is about, it's about enjoying his presence. Hallelujah. I'm about this day, Ray. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, you know, look, I was singing tonight. Yeah, your lips were moving. And no, that's good. That you hear, it's good. That you bring in the sacrifices of praise, it's good. Now, the Father doesn't want anyone to be left out. Father wants you to show you. He wants you to begin to describe how you feel and what your state is. He wants you to begin to live under the sovereign rule of the Lord Jesus Christ and under the authority of his word. Say, this is who I am. I am dead. And my life is hid with God in Christ. And Christ, he is my life. Somebody said, oh, I don't want to get to that level. Now it's a free gift of salvation. It's because you're willing to set your affections on things above. Tonight, let this floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul and show where you're not cooperating, man. It's one thing for people to smile and be willing, look at you with a big smile and face and nod their head like they're willing, and then they just go do whatever it is they're going to do. I mean, just think about it. Papa's talking to you. He's saying some things to you because he wants to bring additions into your life. He's brought all the riches of heaven. He who is rich became poor for our sake. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, that through his poverty we might be made rich. And then when you go through all of the list of items of the unsearchable riches of God, that's just even just named in the epistle of Ephesians, you're going to be overwhelmed with God's goodness for you if you just begin to read. I just published my translation and commentary on the epistle of Ephesians, and I'm charging $500 for each copy. No, I'm not. Thank you. Thanks. It's free for the download. How many downloads have there been? Two, myself and Ann? Because, I mean, the reality of it is, where do you take, you've got to take interest. God has supplied all kinds of things around you. And if you're not careful, you're going to be all focused in on self-interest. This is what you want to do, and this is what you're happy about, and this is what you feel, and this is what you're excited about. And now God's got to work in the realm of what you're happy about and what you feel and what you're excited about. Well, that's pretty limited. It's pretty limited. You get into the Word of God, God will open up for you a great big world that lasts forever. And show you how that you right in the big middle of it all. And then you start recognizing that, my goodness, Father actually gave to us people in our lives that he has anointed as apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers with his glory to speak on his behalf supernatural giftings of the Spirit of the living God, and it's all about you. And yet you don't understand how to connect with that. See, God the Father is crying out to us as he's saying to us, he said, I want you to grow up into all things, into the head, Christ Jesus, from whom, Christ Jesus, every part of the body, speaking of his glorious church, is supplied. He's supplying something. He's supplying the riches and glory. He's supplying those things that belong to his life, those things that belong to his kingdom, the things that belong to his authority and his power, all that you have need of and beyond, more than you can think or ask. But that's not going to be real to you. That won't be real to you so long as that problem is there and it can control you. Or if it can't control you, it can influence you. And you know when it's going to come? It's going to come at the moment that God wants to do something great and now just shut you down, and now you're just feeling like bad or distracted. I made my children sit in church, and I showed people how to raise their children in the kingdom of God. And if you model after it, you're going to have the same result. I guarantee you. You don't? I don't know what result you're going to get. You have to recognize that. There are things we want. God's purpose to raise up more than just a one generation. He's purpose to raise up a culture of the kingdom that exists in every generation. And we've not been willing to participate with that. They're going to go read this book and read that book, get counsel from this devil and counsel from this, you know, that over there, whatever that is. Let's just call it man. And get a little counsel from God and join them all together and shake and bake. And then live off that. Come on now, dear people. Understand me. I'm just crying out to you, but the Spirit of the Lord is saying, it's time to come and start living by the Word of God. People don't have time for the Bible. You don't have time. You messed up, and I want to break that yoke from off of you tonight. Because if you'll begin to start communicating with God, if you'll begin to start enjoying the bread of life, if you begin to start enjoying the very presence of the living Word, who is expressed and revealed through the written Word, everything about your life is going to change. Somebody said, I read the Bible once. Like big deal. I've read it hundreds of times, and I'm still just starting to get it. You read it one time. I mean, it's not even an introduction. It's like people say, well, it's supposed to be impressed because you read it one time. All the way through Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. How much of it did you understand? Yes, good point. Yeah. Right? Are you listening to me? No, everybody's got a photographic memory until they're taking a test. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Hello. Come on now, people. Papa God, the Holy Spirit, and Christ Jesus is laying it on us here tonight. He wants to bring us in to a relationship with him where we're totally dependent upon him all the time so he can show forth his glory through our lives. There's yokes got to be broken. There's things that you've allowed to rule over your mind and your thinking and your life that you're going to have to stand up against and say, no more. The things that you've called impossible, the things that you say, I just can't manage, I'm frustrated, you just don't understand, that you put in the category of can't do it, that's going to have to change for you. You're going to have to understand when you lay hold on the anointing and the things of the Spirit, you can do all things through Christ Jesus, who strengthens you. I want you just to be seated. God wants to supply to you, for you, listen to me, God Almighty, the living God, the creator of the heaven and the earth, wants to supply to you tonight all things that pertain to life and godliness. He wants to provide for you according to and out of his riches and glory. Cemetery, right? Some of you look like a child sitting at the table and you don't want to eat your green beans. And your dad say, you eat the green beans because they're good for you. Tonight, I could just, it just, just to see, I'm not at all happy with anything that's going on within the framework of the moving of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ today in the United States, because for me it doesn't fully reveal and look like Jesus. And so I'm doing is here tonight encouraging you. I praise God for the church. I praise God for your life. Listen, but fine, that's wonderful. It's time to grow up. And if you grow up in every dimension of all that you can handle right now that Christ Jesus is supplying, next week we're going to tell you the same thing, because your heart will be enlarged to grow up some more. To have the Spirit of the Lord be expressed in your life in greater ways, so that the brightness of His glory and the beauty of His person begins to shine on your face all the time. Because otherwise, you're not going to be a witness. Nobody really cares about what you're saying when it's not something that's really worked for you. And look, e presto tane ke. If you would just respond to the Spirit of the Lord and reach out and take that cup that's right in front of you and begin to drink it. If you would take a hold of the word of life that's coming to you right now by the Spirit of the Lord and say that it's mine. Yes, Lord, that's what I want. And that would be the way that you would begin to receive these things that are being said in your heart. And you would begin to respond to the Holy Ghost as though you were drinking, you were thirsty, you were desperate for water, and you began to drink those things that the Spirit of the Lord is supplying. There would be a bubble up, an outpouring going on in your life right now. Has nothing to do with how big the church is, who's ministering. It has nothing to do with that. You could be in prison right now, in a pit somewhere, and if you would respond to the anointing and the presence of the Lord, you would have a great moving of God in your life. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I just want you to go ahead and take a hold of the moving of God right there in front of you. I want you to take a hold of the moving of God right there and just begin to respond to Him. Don't try too hard. Don't try. Relax. Just respond to the ministry. The manifestation, God said the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is given to every man. That's here right now. And that's all I'm saying. I'm talking about you in your personal relationship with the Lord being able to respond to the one who right now is supplying something. Because first and foremost, there's going to have to be a desire in your heart to grow up into Him who is the head. Because maybe if there's not the, I'm going to just live big for myself right now and take a back seat in heaven. I'm just going to do my own thing and know that in the end, God's love will be able to sustain me. I'm going to slip into heaven on a banana peel or get saved by the skin of my teeth or whatever. Listen, the heart's wrong. It's just not going to work. But tonight, if you're hungry and you're thirsty to be able to grow up into Him, if that's exciting to you, to recognize you can grow up into Him and to all things, who is the head of Christ Jesus? And that He's supplying to you all the wealth and all the riches and all the things of heaven so that you now at this very moment can begin to respond to that which is going on and receive that which is going on. And He is given out of the realms of heaven. Everything about the way that you act, the way that you know and interact with God, with people around you, would change starting right this very second. So, we were singing, we were crying out to God, take your sovereign power and reign. Because for us, here in this place, for us singing is just prayer set to music. We're just praying. We're asking God to do something. Well, and really, and that has its very different expressions of praise and has its very different expressions of worship. We're saying, oh Lord, take your sovereign power and come rule here tonight. Come reign over me. Come fill me here tonight. Somebody said, well, I don't agree with that doctrine. I believe that He should be filling you all the time. I agree with you, He should be filling you all the time. Well, why don't we just go ahead and start with tonight? Come fill me here tonight. The Spirit of the Lord is here to take us and baptize us into one body, Christ Jesus. Somebody said, well, I got baptized by the Holy Ghost into one body so many years ago. It's supposed to happen all the time. You're supposed to be willing to yield to the Spirit of the Lord. And by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. And that's got to become something more than just a religious ideology or a concept about something that happened to somebody 2,000 years ago, and recognize that the church, it's the same church right now as existed 2,000 years ago. You can decide whether you want to grow, whether you want to mature, whether you want to change or not. And if you decide that you're going to, that you want to change, then God the Holy Spirit is there supplying your very heart, which is the center of your intellect, the center of your emotions, and the center of your volition, your will, your willingness to respond. You know, if you get stubborn against God, you get discouraged in a situation, that actually becomes a response of your heart. And your heart, it's like shuts the door to the moving of God. But the Spirit of the Lord is here to supply to you everything that Father wants to be established in your life. And what he's saying is, come here. I want you to grow up into him, the head, Christ Jesus. I want you to grow up into him in all things, every dimension of that which he has. And he's supplying all that he has to you and me. Now, having received that which he has supplied, now having a proper connection in the body of Christ, that proper connection that comes as a result of being rooted and grounded and settled in love, something begins to happen. There is a supply now that comes out of you to everybody else around you. Now, all of a sudden, the manifestation of the Spirit isn't just for a couple of people. Now, it's just not about a couple of champions in God who know how to flow in the anointing and know how to flow in the manifest presence of God, and everybody falls out under the power of God, under the influence of their relationship with the Lord and the anointing that they've received. Suddenly, there begins to be an enlargement of your heart and an ability that you personally can begin to receive the riches that are coming, the unsearchable riches that are coming from Christ Jesus, the supply of the Holy Ghost, all his provision, all that he has of. My God shall supply all of my needs, all of your needs according to his riches and glory. Now, I know what people do. What they're going to do is they're going to reduce that to a place of monetizing it. Listen, it's far more than that earthly riches and money. My goodness gracious, Father has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. But what if you're not really interested in the heavenly realm because you're on your earthly pursuits? Well, you got yourself a problem. What if you're mostly interested in the heavenly realm, but you got a few interests in the earthly pursuits? Father wants to help you with that as well. And the way that he does is he just reaches into our lives and he begins to turn our hearts towards him so that we can have an understanding of how to receive from him so that we can begin to enjoy his presence. So I want you to lift your hands towards heaven right now. And I want you to enjoy his presence. See how that works for you. Just enjoy his presence. Don't try too hard. Don't start praying, oh God, what's wrong with me? Just enjoy his presence. Sabra da kesht. Enjoy his presence. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that breaks off, that destroys, that removes out of the way everything that would be a stronghold, everything that would block entrance to you, everything that would sway the mind or turn the heart. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Just let the Spirit of the living God overwhelm you. Let the goodness of God take you. Hallelujah. Just begin to thank him for his love for you. Just begin to thank him. Look, you know what I said? Begin to thank him for his love for you. Three people responded. Three people. You just got to recognize that that's the problem. God has something to say about hearers only. They're not going to get nowhere. Really, God says, you're getting nowhere. Hearers only, you're getting nowhere. You got to do it.
You just begin to say, Lord, thank you so much for your love for me. It's like do it kind of thing. You know, think about it. That's right. Just keep doing it. You're getting some headway. Some of you are making some headway. See, God's here. God is here. All I want to do is hook you up with God Almighty. That's all. Hey, looky here. Guess what? If you don't do what I say, if you don't do what I say, I can't help you. Does that make sense? Look, if you go to the doctor and you don't, and you expect the doctor to help you, and you don't do what the doctor says, guess what? You wasted your money, man. You have to do what's been said to do. Hallelujah. Listen, Naaman could have been arrogant and said, I'm not doing what you said to do. Go wash in Jordan. Dip seven times in the Jordan. I'm from Syria. We've got the mighty Syrian river. That's beautiful. It makes the Jordan look like the muddy creek it is. Praise God, he had some servant with some kind of insight. Said, look, you know, if the prophet would have said for you to go, you know, kill 10,000 people and then your leprosy would be healed, you would have done it. Said some mighty deed you had to go get done. Spoke to the realms of your pride of life, you'd have gone and done it. All I said was raise your hands towards heaven and say, Lord, thank you for your love. And I'm telling you right now, not everybody in this place participated. And I want you to understand that's exactly why you are where you're at. Now, guess what? God doesn't hold the power over that. God doesn't hold the power over that. God does not hold the power over that. You hold the power over that. That was the response of your own will. That was the response of what you've created and developed in your life. God, the Holy Spirit, speaking things like this all the time through His Word. He is instructing us in the ways of life, and we don't do it. We go, that's interesting. Wow. My. Jesus. Hallelujah. Everybody that was on the platform is doing pretty well right now.
Thank you, Father in heaven. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, you know what? You need to shout unto the Lord. You need to give your emotions over to God. Let me just tell you right now. People have unholy emotions, all kinds of iniquity going on in their life, all kinds of things that belong to death, not to life, sadness, sorrow, depression, and the works, because they've never given their emotions over to God. Oh, it's a weird and terrible thing when people start shouting under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, but it's something wonderful when everybody's screaming their head off and dressing up like an idiot at the football game. That's cool. That's totally cool. That's all acceptable. Or when everybody's acting like a fool. Hey, you know what? You know what? They were singing the night in France when the terrorist group came in and shot them. They were singing Kiss the Devil. Yeah, and they're all excited about singing. They were into that song, Kiss the Devil. They were going after it with all their slamming around and jerking around. And what happened is they did. It happened for them right at the very instant. Now, but no, get up there in church, those crazy people. Screaming and hollering, jumping around, dancing. You don't understand. There's something greater going on than what can be seen. There's something greater going on than what can be seen. Sukastatari baseyapoho. Sutaravaya sepotoshika. Mitayala basapa yopoho hija. Woo! Hallelujah. Heaven's filled with shouts and praises. God's people are filled with shouts and praises. Look. Look. Oh, Sabayo, Saya Sayopo, Sayateo, Prabasiteo, Pupate. Pisatalo, Mungasipayalo, Pusia. Mane Rebeshi, Menda Romongaila. The Holy Spirit wants to come and begin to explode on the inside of you. Explode in your emotions. Explode in the realms of those things that you know and understand. Man, when God is allowed to fill you with the pleasures that are in heaven, in His presence is fullness of joy, at His right hand is pleasures forevermore. When you begin to allow the Spirit of the Lord to fill you with the holy emotions of His joy and of His love and His peace, of His glory and of His goodness. Oh, I tell you, everything begins to be redefined in your life. Listen, I watch over and again where people live under the torment of sorrow and sadness. You can see it in their eyes. You can see it in the expressions of the life. And they're saying, oh, I'm just choosing to do whatever I want to do. You're an idiot. You didn't. Nobody in their right mind is going to choose to be depressed and tormented and sad and sorrowful. You are under the rule of the power of death and a demon spirit. And you, by your own will, allowed it. Because God gave you the opportunity to shout. He gave you the opportunity to get happy. He gave you the opportunity. Hallelujah. He gave you the opportunity for the water courses of heaven to be able to fill you. Santa Rabosa, Mangaya Sapota. Hallelujah. 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 Kisha Raboso Go Yamahane. Oh, Sapayo! Oh, Sapayo! Hallelujah. This is how we wake up happy every morning. This is why my wife never chews me out and complains at me and belittles me and tries to subdue me and take my position of authority away. You're listening to me. You know, you guys know how the scripture says, husbands obey your wives. No, I mean, wives obey your husbands after you argue with them for 2 hours. No, people don't understand how to live in this peace. They don't understand how to live in this joy. They don't understand how to live in this glory. Thus, even in Holy Ghost churches, there is so much division. There's so much sin in the camp. There's so much weirdness going on. There's no togetherness. The connection doesn't take place. Therefore, the supply that is coming down from the Lord Jesus Christ that is supposed to be flowing between God's people isn't happening. Thus, the manifestation of the Spirit that is given to every person in the house can't work. The supply isn't coming. The supply, there's a broken pipe, as it were. Because people are not allowing God to have free course in their life. He wants all of His water courses, as the psalmist described it, to be able to flow through us. And He described those water courses in the context of rejoicing. He described those water courses. It is literally an analogy or a simile of the Spirit of the living God flowing through our emotions. He described them as rejoicing. He described them as joy. He described them as praise. He described them as thanksgiving. People go whole days yielding their members to every kind of unthankful thing, sorry, sour attitude. What happens when all of a sudden you now become ruled by the sovereign Jesus Christ, the sovereign power of the Holy Ghost? And you don't allow anything else. You just don't allow it. And if something's tormenting you and running you down, people, I'm going to tell you right now, I know good and well that if someone broke into your house, that you would, you know, there. I don't see a coward among us that I know of. You would tackle the person and you would wrestle them to the ground. Huh? But yet, spiritually, thieves break through into your life all the time. Beat the snot out of you, man. Huh? Push you around, rub your nose in the dirt, step on you, do all kinds of weird stuff to you. Are you listening to me? You... I can't do nothing about it. It's nonsense. You allow it. I mean, if you'd begin to understand the weapons of your warfare, which are not carnal but mighty, you begin to understand the weapons of my warfare. It's the shout in the Holy Ghost. It's a shout. Hey, look, the shout in the Holy Ghost is one of the greatest weapons identified in the Old Testament. When the prophet came to Jehoshaphat, and Jehoshaphat saying, there's no way we can stand against this army. They're too mighty for us. They're too big for us. We're going to need some help. We're going to have some divine help. Send for the prophet so we can find out what we're supposed to do, how we're supposed to get some supernatural help. Maybe he's going to design a new weapon for us. And the prophet walks in and says, Jehoshaphat, today you're going to lay down your shield. You're going to lay down your swords, your bows, your arrows, and all your weapons of war that you trust in. And today you guys are going to go out and sing to the enemy. Today you're going to go out to the mighty army, you're going to lift up your voice, and you're going to begin to shout praises to the Almighty. You're going to show them how to dance in the Holy Ghost. He's showing a weapon of our warfare. Paul in prison, Paul and Silas in prison at night. I mean, you talk about the miserable situation they were in. They were taken out, grown men stripped naked in public and beaten. And then thrown in a deep, dark pit, a hole called a prison, and chained to the wall. And they begin to shout. They begin to lift up their voice and praise. Woo! Something happened. The place, there's a breakout in the shout. And you're going to have to learn it. You have to learn that God gave you that voice, and not for hollering and yelling at people. Hey, listen, a yell's from hell. Shout to the Lord. Yeah! Hallelujah. You start doing that, every devil in hell runs scared. You don't understand it. People sit there and they try to do all this spiritual warfare, and they pray and cry out. And the devil's just going, hey, man, that's pretty cool. You look weird, but it's pretty cool. Doesn't threaten me. You look really occupied and busy, and it has no impact on me. So pretty cool. But you begin to shout, you begin to lift up your voice and praise to God so loud that nothing else matters. You begin to get caught away in His goodness. You begin to get caught away in His presence. You begin to let your spirit, your heart, your emotions, your affections touch heaven. Father, I need you now. But it's not done in doubt and unbelief. It's not done in a complaint. It is done in a place of desperation. It's done in a place of certainty. It's done in a place of confidence. It's done in a place that of neediness. And God, the Holy Ghost, invades that and fills it, dear people. I guarantee you, it's the cure for every. I got the remedy right here for every sickness and disease. It's where you touch the realms of that which Christ Jesus supplies, because He supplies healing. It's the children's bread. He supplies continually all this divine provision of ability, of power, and of authority. And he supplies for us the things that we need in the realms of faith to see wealth created and finances produced. But we've got to receive the supply and quit walking around in some kind of mental ascent, some kind of mental understanding of these things. God's not interested in that which you think that you know. He's interested in the affections of your heart. When he went into Simon's house, Simon the Pharisee, there was the great men, learned men of the law of God, the word of God. They knew everything about the Bible. They knew every verb tense, where to find it. They could have quoted the whole of it, starting from Genesis all the way through 2 Chronicles, because it's the way that the Bible's laid out. Jesus wasn't interested in that. He simply walked in. You know, they were all lobbying for position and had all their order going on, you know, all their protocol
just went over and sat down, and it wasn't too long, a woman come rushing into the place. Somebody didn't belong there, but it was like going on, don't let her touch you. You'd be unclean, be contaminated. She runs to Jesus, and she begins to kiss his feet. That's church service right there going on. There's some praise going on now. Hallelujah. Now the affections of the heart are being manifested. She began to kiss his feet, and she began to wash his feet with her tear and dry them with her hair. Jesus looked immediately, says to Simon, Simon, as Simon saying, if he was a prophet, he would know what kind of woman is that touches him. So he, knowing the thoughts of his heart, turned to him and said, Simon, when I came in, you didn't give me any kisses. People don't understand how to kiss him. They don't understand how to adore him. You're stuck in the realms of circumstance and that which you can visually behold. You're locked. Many people are locked and go from prison to prison, event to event, situation to situation. Every once in a while, they have a little break. I mean, they live in the valley of the shadow of death. You know what? You're supposed to get through that quickly. They'll walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I fear no evil. Amen. That's a good place to live. You'd be rejoicing all the way through the valley. You're supposed to be living in the mountaintop in the glory of heaven. You're supposed to be living in the highest place of all. Habakkuk said, I go up and find my high place. God called Abraham up into his high place. God always had his altar most of the time built in a high place. Just getting men closer to heaven, as it were. The Lord calls you and me into the highest place of all. He calls us to come live in the holies of holies. Down and out in the holies of holies. I mean, that is just absolutely crazy. To be a street bum in the holies of holies. To be poor and without and dejected and depressed and weary and tormented and tired and overwhelmed and run down, run out, burn out. One time I had the head of the Assemblies of God in Papua New Guinea, he calls me up. He says, we want you to come and be the keynote speaker at our conference this year for all of our leaders in Papua New Guinea and some from Indonesia and Bougainville. And he said, we're going to the topic of the conference is burnout. I said, let me just tell you right now, I don't even need to come. Let me just tell you what to do. They that wait upon the Lord will not burn out. Let me just give you your answer right here on the phone. You don't even need me to come. It's a long flight anyways. I did go. I said, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will not burn out. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Hallelujah. I mean, the young men shall faint and utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord. Come on, dear people. What we're talking about is we're talking about an interaction. We're talking about a receptivity of that which God has to continually supply to us. Listen to the faith realm. When you know that that's the truth, if you're feeling and having or experiencing anything other than that, you're not going to stand for it. Because somebody's putting something on you that they have no right to put on you. Or somehow you, with your own will, are refusing that which God is supplying to us according to his riches in glory, out of the realms of his unsearchable riches. See, this is believing God. This is letting God be God. This is having a relationship. It's moving from religion to relationship. It's interacting with the Almighty. It's moving out of our own understanding and concepts. Everybody's going to come around you and they're going to tell you what your life means and how things are going to work out for you and what it's going to look like. You need to you can be gracious and listen, but just shut that down. Say, Father, erase that right now in Jesus' name. Lest it should somehow be mingled with your word now be contaminated with all of the suggestions of men and devils, and now no longer have power to produce within my life that which you commanded. Hear me. God's word works. When you speak his word, believe his word, stand in his word, you get his results. He sent forth his word to heal us, Christ Jesus, the living word. I want you to grab a hold of the reality of it. I want you to understand the faith that comes by it. I want you to realize that you don't have to go some special place to get some kind of special wisdom and some kind of special revelation to have it. God says it's right there. It's right here, right now, in your heart and in your mouth, so that you may do it. I want you to hear me. And the Lord said that the first time in the context of Deuteronomy chapter 30, when the Lord was describing to Israel all their greatness and all the wealth. There's a bunch of slaves standing around poor. All they have is the clothes on their back. They had some gold, but they gave it to Aaron. He turned it into a calf, a golden calf to worship, and it fell down into hell. And now they don't have nothing. And all they got is clothes on their back, and they're standing there going, as God describes to them on this glory. And Moses says, listen, I'm going to show you how this works. The word of God is near unto you. It's in your heart and in your mouth that you may be able to do all these things, that you may be able to do it. Be great in God. Have all that he is supplying. Live out this glorious life of divine power. Understand how to yield to the Holy Ghost instead of sitting around grunting. You know what I'm saying? Groaning, murmuring, and complaining. People, listen, if that's going on in your life, it's the first thing you want to get fixed. Don't focus on everything at once. Just focus on the problem at hand. The Lord will shine a spotlight on your shoulder and show you exactly why you don't allow that the flow of heaven's not continually supplied in your spirit. He'll show you why, how it is you isolate yourself from that which he's given you, how unbelief is able to work in your heart, how discouragement is able to work in your heart. If you listen to him, he'll give you instruction, and you'll be able to stop it. It won't have power over you anymore. Won't have power over you anymore. Huh? Because what God makes you, he makes you a soldier. He makes you someone who has, as a warrior, with divine authority. Jesus Christ is called the captain of our salvation. You understand me? Not the facilitator. He's the captain. He's a soldier. He's in the army of the Lord. And we know when Joshua saw him, he came with drawn sword. And Joshua was ready to take him on. He said, are you for us or against us? Because I'm deciding whether right now whether we're going to tangle. That's what is going down. And then the Lord said, no, as the captain of the host, as the captain of the armies. It's like a host. We translate it host, and many of your Bibles has it host, but literally it means armies. See, God, he is the Lord of armies. Yes, he is. That's what James called him, and I know the word was Sabaoth. Yeah, listen, he's the Lord of armies. Yes. Hallelujah. Because there are things that have come out within the realms of the powers of darkness to stop everything that God has purposed for us to live in and to have. And I want you to just understand this and by this example. And understand me. The spiritual world is different now than it was then in the days of Daniel. In the days of Daniel, Daniel began to read the Bible. He began to read what Jeremiah prophesied. And he realized, wait a minute, the time has come and passed. There was 70 years, and the time has come and passed. We should have already had our deliverance. Something's going on. In other words, he's saying, wait a minute, the time of revival and the moving of God has come and gone. And so what does he do? He begins to lift up his voice. He begins to cry out to God. He begins to make intercession in Jesus' name. Here we go. Crackers, cookies, cheese, milk. Breaking all the rules. Doll baby, everything right here. Breaking all the rules. Right here in my house. He begins to cry out to God for deliverance so that the things that Father... First of all, he's got to believe that God's faithful concerning his promise. He's got to believe that what God said in his word is something that's a reality for right now. Do you know how many people read God's word and don't believe it's a reality? I heard somebody spilling the biggest bunch of nonsense on Facebook the other day, saying, well, you know, so-and-so who's got supposedly in the office of a prophet, he's all sick and diseased because he took on the principality of Iran and Saudi Arabia and they had permission to knock him dead. That is the biggest bunch of garbage that could even be imagined. And now all these preachers just gullible. They're just so gullible, just receiving that in. Oh, wow, that is so tragic. Don't pray against Iran, for heaven's sake.
And let's out here, oh, Rabbi alone. Let's just stay over here in our little corner. That is so demonic. That's so born right out of hell. And if they just knew the word of God, they would have realized what kind of nonsense was being fed to them. Jesus has given us all authority. He has all authority in heaven and earth. He told us to go into all the world and preach the gospel. He gave us power to cast out every unclean spirit, to deal with every spiritual wickedness in high places. He's far above all principalities. The principality of Iran. I was in a dream and I saw three guys sitting there, big angels. One had different uniform on than the other one. One had death, and there was a list of prophets on the hit list. Nonsense. How did anybody even start listening to him? It's so opposite from the word of God. People believe everything that God's word's not saying and believe very little that his word is saying. They won't listen to what God prophesied over them. They go stand in line to hear what some prophesier want to prophesy over them. And many of them, in many situations, it's soothsayers, saith the Lord. Not prophets at all. Listen to me. Daniel believed the word. God said it. It should happen. 7 years had passed. How many things have you read in the word and you just, I don't have that. Well, something bad wrong with me or something's wrong with God. And usually we don't say something's wrong with God. You just say something's bad wrong with me. God don't like me. Well, if you just would know and believe the love that God has for you, you wouldn't believe that lie. Huh? You'd be able to dwell in God. If you just obey God's commandments, you'd dwell in him and he'd dwell in you, and the love of God would be perfected in you. When the love of God is perfected in you, my goodness, fear can't work, because perfect love casts out fear. How easy it is to have perfect love. Listen to me. How easy it is. Go memorize 1 John 4:15 and 1 John 2:5. Just do that. Get the word of God on the inside of you. Start living by the word of God. Start processing by the word of God. See if you read the word of God and say, wait a minute, I'm supposed to have this in my life. I prayed for a woman this morning. I wanted to go pray for her because I wanted the power of God to be gushing out of her. I've got to spend whatever amount of time there is to break through her doubt and unbelief. See, the power of God is right there ready for her. She could have received all that she wants, but she's just too satisfied with her own life. She's read the Bible too many times with blinders on and don't recognize that she's missing out on a big part of what God, Christ Jesus, paid for us at Calvary's cross and provided it for us when he rose from the dead and ascended up on high and poured out this glory from on high. See, so many people, they submit to, or they recognize, or they will participate with Jesus' earthly ministry, which is essential, the cross, death, burial, and resurrection, but they don't participate with his heavenly ministry. He's got an ongoing ministry right now. Praise God, he died once. That's not an ongoing ministry, as it were. He did that, it's done, it's effective for everybody who's going to believe. But he's got an ongoing ministry. He's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost. That's ongoing. He is pouring out his spirit from on high. He's hooked up in the prayer meeting, and that's why he ever lives, to make intercession for the saints. He's in the middle of praise, because we understand, I and the children which the Lord has given to me are both for signs and wonders, as he stands in the center of the congregation giving praise unto the Father. Amen. With a mighty shout. Yes. Hallelujah. Father wants to teach you how to have a mighty shout in your life when the doubt comes flooding in. He wants you to learn how to dance some more. He wants you to learn how to get happy some more. I found out how to break off the yoke of sickness. Dance around. One day, it was before I stepped into divine understanding how divine healing works. And I was terribly, I became terribly sick. I mean, I was so sick, I couldn't move. I ached to even, I was so sick and I hurt so bad, it hurt to blink. So I tried not to blink. I mean, it was just that bad. And I all of a sudden I remembered that Jacob laid a dying, the scripture says, and now he's on his deathbed. And he got up off his deathbed just for a minute to lean upon his staff to worship the Lord. And he lived about 30, 40 years after that. You know, so I mean, I said, wait a minute, there's a key. All I gotta do is get up off this bed and start worshiping God. That's all I got to do, is get up and start praising him. So I got up off the couch and was like, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God, thank you that you love me so much. And he got to get a little louder and a little louder. And the shout broke out. Hallelujah. Because you begin to cooperate with God. God sees. See, we think he's blind. We think he's aloof from our issues and from our problems. We think he's somehow in a heaven somewhere far, far away. No, God wants you to have a personal relationship with him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He wants you to have a personal relationship with you. He did not die at Calvary so you could come into a religion. Father wants you to have a personal relationship with you. He wants you to have an experience where you know that he is with you and in you. The Lord Jesus said in that day that the Holy Ghost comes that you read about in John chapter 14. In that day, beginning verse 17 through 21, you will know that I am in you. First of all, he says, you will know that the Father is in me. Listen to me. I'm going to help you out with the understanding of the Trinity right now. You with me? First of all, you'll know that the Father is in me. And you will know that I am in you. So the Father is in Jesus, just like Jesus is in you and me. Come on, listen to me now. Huh? We want to argue about the things of whether the Holy Ghost will come on you and remain, or where the Holy Ghost comes on you and lifts off. And they sit there and argue with each other. Neither one of them experienced either experience at all. And they're getting further and further away as they argue. Listen, the word of God is that which God has sent, the miraculous provision which God has sent from heaven so that you and I can hear it and respond to it. And he's watching, and he's interacting, and he's seeing, and he's standing here, and he beholds our response to his word. Listen to me. He beholds our response to his word. And when we respond and we do it, and I don't care how weak the response is, God, the Holy Ghost, is going to invade that. Hallelujah. He is. He is. He will invade that. He will invade that act of obedience. The word of God is nigh you in your mouth and in your heart so that you can do all and be all that God has said that you could do and be. No man is able to keep you from all the provision of heaven. Hallelujah. When you think about the supply, the Lord's inviting us. He's saying that we can grow up into him, into all things. We can grow up into the head, Christ Jesus, into all things, who supplies to the body. Listen, I'm telling you right now, when I was born of the Spirit, I was born into a new race. Hallelujah. If you've been born in the Spirit, you belong to a whole new race. Abraham stepped into a covenant relationship with God, and a race was born. It's called Ivrit. Ivrit is how we say Hebrew in the Hebrew language. Ivrit means to stand on the other side, away from the population of humanity, on the other side of the flood, standing there with God. It was Abraham and God. God created a new race. We call them Jews today, or Hebrews today, or Israelites today, because all of us sudden a name came upon them, and a blessing of a name are those who wrestle with God, those who lay hold on the promises of God, to say, Father, that's what was going on with Jacob. I gotta have your protection because Esau is gonna kill me. I gotta have your help right now. I gotta have a divine supply for right now that I know only you can produce, because my life is going to come to an end and all that I have is going to be destroyed unless you come help me. Look at what's going on. Are you willing to believe God enough to respond when you read his word? To say, wait a minute, something is supposed to be happening right now. It's not going on in my life. I'm gonna begin to cry out to God. Daniel began to lift up his voice. He didn't just say, okay, sirrah, sirrah, whatever will be, will be. He didn't have an attitude, well, God, when you get around to it, you sovereign Lord, who can resist your will? He began to personally take up the responsibility for the state and the condition of Israel. And it wasn't just because God had promoted him to the highest office in the land. He was in the midst of a people who hated his race. You know, I think about, for example, the Rothschilds, a family that they carry a curse upon their name today. But when I think about the first Rothschild that stood up and began to say, I'm going to lay hold on the wealth that exists in the world. He lived on an alley that they locked him in at night in Prussia. He was old man. Rothschild belonged to the most hated group of people, most persecuted group of people on the planet. You listening to me? Yes. He laid hold on something. He believed in something. And within two generations, they took over the wealth of the world.
We get stuck and trapped in all of our little mental concepts about all these ideas and all these expressions that men and devils lay upon us, and we buy into it, and then we live out that self-fulfilled prophecy. You hear me? Daniel understood who he was. You need to understand who you are. God promoted him to the highest place and position in land. God has promoted us to the highest place and position in Christ Jesus right now. He's made us a holy people, a royal priesthood. Just let all of the government officials bring whatever they want to bring. We'll have Carmel. Carmel's coming down. We're going to see whose side God is on. It's going to happen. He's the real God. He's not changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's going to show forth his power. He's going to glorify the name of his son, Jesus Christ. Every knee is going to bow. Every tongue is going to confess. These men who believe they're in charge are going to find out they're not in charge at all. God is the one who promotes. He is the one who exalts. He is the one who demotes. He is the one who breaks down or tears down. Nebuchadnezzar was the king of the world. God made him go eat grass like an ox, so he could come to his senses. One day he woke up, Daniel chapter 4, and he recognized that God rules in the kingdom of men. He sets up whom he will, and he pulls down. He builds. He tears down that he may build. He uproots that he may plant. Daniel reading, saying, wait a minute, our time and our opportunity is past. He begins to cry out to God because he knows that God hears him in heaven. He has a relationship with the Lord that has been proven over and over again. And look at what happened. The principalities, the powers of wickedness came out to stop any provision, any supply coming out of heaven from reaching him to bring the answer, to bring the power, to bring the anointing, to bring the favor, to bring the release. That can't happen anymore because Jesus stripped principalities and powers of all that kind of ability when it comes to you and I, the people of God praying, this new race interacting with God, this royal priesthood, this holy nation that he has made us in himself as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not an institution, not a denomination, but an organism, the very body and being of Jesus, the person of Almighty God in the earth right now. That's what the Bible teaches. Men don't teach that, but that's what the Bible teaches. He set us together in a heavenly realm. Our citizenship is in heaven. Our conversation is in heaven. We're seated together with him in a heavenly realm in a place of divine authority. We've abdicated that authority because we've not believed the report that God has given concerning himself and the report that God has given concerning his church. But the tide's changing. You listen to me. The tide is changing. My family started preaching in the United States of America in 1620. My great-great aunt became so intolerable, they hung her in the Boston House of Commons in Massachusetts. They have a monument to her today there. She's canonized by the Fox's Book of Martyrs, the first American martyr. We've been preaching the things of the Spirit of the living God and the purpose of the living God. This nation is a refuge for all the nations of the earth. It's a place for ISIS to come. It's a place for the terrorists to come. It's a place for the poverty stricken to come. It's a place for all peoples to come. And the power of the Holy Ghost is supposed to be continually falling. And it's going to happen again. Amen. It was the early 1700s. And our family was preaching. And I don't care about people want to talk about a history. I don't need nobody to tell me my family history. The power of God was going forth. The word of God was going forth because there was uncompromising preachers in the United States of America when it was still just in the formative stages. And a great awakening took place that Thomas Jefferson was in. As George Whitefield preached, as John Wesley preached, as a host of other people that are not as famous begin to preach. And out of that begin to be born an idea of being a lighthouse into the nations. And God, in his grace and his mercy, within the framework of government, gave something to protect the church called the Constitution. It was designed to protect the church more than anything else. I believe in the church, separation of church and state. When it wasn't a separation of church and state, they hung my great aunt.
because she didn't pay tithe. In the Boston, Massachusetts colony didn't have taxes then, 1620. It was tithe. It was run by the Puritans. It was the government. It was run by the church. Go read your history. Well, you have to go back, you know, and get the history books pre-1950. Because who knows what they're saying now? It's just spin doctrine. It's whoever had money to pay to bring in whatever it is they decided they wanted to edit and change about it all. But right now, the Lord has said to you and me, he says to us, he said, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. He's saying to us, he's saying, I'm giving you all strength and I'm giving you all power and I've given you all might. I've given you my strength and my power and my might so that you may effectively deal with spiritual wickedness. So that anything comes out to try to stop you and try to prevent the supply from coming from you, you just rise up in an authority that Christ Jesus has given you. People sit around and let the devil run right over top of them because they don't know their authority. Listen to me. Listen to me. Yeah, the troublings of the water will come, as it were. The movings of God will come. There was in the meeting, and I say this just to, as an example, not to bring attention to myself, but an example of the troubling of the water and how sometimes, how no matter how anointed people are, they seem to can't step into the healing that God has for them. But there was a dear brother here in the meeting with us one night. So we were at the church just about two blocks down here at 10180 Willow Creek Road before we moved over here. See, I'm here because God told me to move in here. Somebody said, well, why are you here? Because God told me to move in here. Well, I don't believe that. Well, why don't you just push and shove around a little bit and see, shake things up a little bit. Maybe you can find out really what's going on. Because I'm sure he'll show himself. You know what I'm telling you? And just listen to me, because like I said, I got a point I want to make. We just think that we're in charge and man makes his own destiny. That's nonsense. Yeah, you decide where you're going to end up. The choice is yours. It's set before you, life and death, good and evil. You know, it's right before you. It's what you're going to choose. But at any rate, a man who was in the early days with Reinhard Bonnke. He was a great man of God. He raised up one of the great churches of America. And, you know, he's used in great crusades even into this day. And he was ministering the church, and his dear wife was with us. They were staying in our house. They were ministering church for the weekend. And he preached, and I was going to pray for the sick at the end of the meeting. And as I'm walking down the line praying for the sick, I looked over and I saw a demon spirit on her, and I ran over and I said, you foul spirit of hell, I command you to go now in Jesus' name. And for the first time in 20 years, she was completely out of pain. She woke up the next morning at our house and she says, it's amazing how often we forget the authority that God has placed in our life. Yeah, the authority of God that God has placed in our life, if we just simply know how to move under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, if we simply learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost, if we simply allow God to make us, you know, those people that don't look so upstanding anymore and respectable, because we all dance around shouting, praising God, hallelujah. We're just beside ourselves in the anointing because we've allowed the Holy Ghost to take over our emotions and train us. And I'm going to tell you right now, when he first starts moving in your life, if you could do backflips, you would do them. There's a couple of people who can do backflips. I know Miles can do backflips. He can run up beside the wall and do a flip. I mean, but we don't want to see that. But I mean, you just move in, the power of God moves upon you. The shout comes in your life. And then all of a sudden you recognize that the shout is there when you're having to deal with opposition and persecution, when you're having to deal with financial crisis, when you're having to deal with physical crisis, when you're having to deal with emotional crisis, when you're having to deal with any kind of opposition. The shout is there to produce the results that God has purposed to supply to us as our deliverer. He's our Savior. He's come to deliver us out of everything we get ourselves into. Everything that comes out against us, he's the deliverer.
Yeah.
Jesus said, people say, well, Jesus is my Savior. Well, did he save you today? He's my Savior. Well, won't you let him save you now because you look like you need to be saved? Your face needs a visitation from heaven. Your faith needs a visitation from heaven. Oh, just to begin to recognize who we are, what God said we are, what he's appointed to us, the position that he's given to us, the magnitude of grace that has been poured out upon us. Hallelujah. I like what Dr. Brown recently said on Facebook. He said, you know, Noah wasn't saved by grace. He had to go to work and build the ark, otherwise he'd have drowned just like everybody else.
He had to take the instruction that was provided by the grace of God and do what God said to do. Otherwise, you're going to drown with everybody else. And that's some work, people. Let's get up out of your lazy state and start moving around under the authority and energy that God Himself provides by His divine power. Hallelujah. If you'll start letting the Word of God rule your mind and your heart, if you start letting the Word of God govern what you think about yourself or what you can do, everything changes. What happens is we allow men to define it, because people don't give themselves to the reading of the Word. God says to Joshua, as he's standing there trying to help him understand how to recognize that the Word of God is there in your heart, in your mouth, so that you may do it. He's saying, listen, what you're going to have to do, as they're standing there looking at this great inheritance, of this great provision, of this great calling, of this great election, to take this people who was born in slavery and been in slavery for more than 200 years and make out of them the capital kingdom of the nations of the world, the crowning jewel of all the earth, to make them a people above all other people, to give them the riches and the wealth that exists in the whole entirety of God's creation. And they're standing there looking like this, and he says to them, this is what you're going to have to do if you want to be successful. You're going to have to recite his word continually. Recite his word continually. Recite it. Because all you gotta do, otherwise you're going to remember about being a slave. You're going to remember about being oppressed. You're going to remember about how you're unable, how you're unfit, how you're unworthy, how you can't do it. Recite the word continually. I know that King James translated that particular Hebrew word that literally means to recite, to continually recite. Translated it meditate. No, it's not sitting around doing no meditation. Not think, think, think. It's speak, speak, speak. It's let the word of his mouth begin to be effectively produced out of your mouth as you confess a salvation comes. Hallelujah. Bandera say, of you, because you proclaim God's word, not your word, not man's word, not a mixture of God's word and your word, but what Father said about us. When you believe what God says about you, you'll get earnest about it and you'll stomp your foot and say, wait a minute, something bad's going around here. I don't have right now what God has said I should have. And I'm not going to sit here and tolerate my will or anybody else's will defying what God has purposed. I'm going to rise up out of this situation. I've found, dear people, that really the devil is not any consequence. You're the consequence. You're the real issue here. If you'll stand up and you'll begin to lift up your voice, the Lord has made his salvation so easy. Those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Ha, 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 ha. You know, the jailer seeing Paul and Silas and seeing them having now been liberated by the power of God that shook the place as though there were a great earthquake, and their chain having fallen off their arm and the doors and the gates being opened, said, what must I do to be saved? Paul made it real simple. It's call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved and your house. Hallelujah. Why don't you learn how to call? Why don't you learn how to lift up your voice and cry out? Why don't you learn how to shout out of the problem? Why don't you learn how to shout and watch how that there's a breakout in the shout? Watch how that the walls come down in a shout. Watch how that the armies are destroyed before you with the shout and with the praise. Because God said the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty in God. It's God power, the weapons of the praise, the weapons of the shout, the weapons of the prayer, the weapons of the rejoicing, the weapons of the word, the weapons of the Spirit of the Lord. If you would begin to recognize bad attitudes as that which will destroy you and keep you from all the success that God has planned for you, you're going to look at a bad attitude as an enemy, and you're going to get your attitude adjusted. You're going to get your attitude right by allowing the Spirit of God come fill you with His kindness and fill you with His goodness and fill you with His love and fill you with His joy and fill you with His peace. It's real easy, people. It's real easy to be successful in God. It's real easy to have all these riches that Father has supplied for us by His riches in glory through Christ Jesus. It's real easy to be blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. All you got to do is begin to set your affections on things above and not on things of this earth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mangando ste prete. Set your affections on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God.
Set your affections on the things of the riches of God. He's supplied to us a treasure, and he's planted a treasure on the inside of you. You have a treasure on the inside of you right now. And the excellency of the glory is of God and not of men. Out of this treasure is every kind of wealth and riches that exist. It's a faith realm that produces every kind of provision that is imaginable for the spiritual realm of man, for the physical realm of men, for the material realm of men, so that men can be something that is impossible within the framework of humanity to be. That is only possible when the anointing of God and the grace of God and a favor of God has come upon you. People have allowed culture and caste systems to oppress them. Culture and caste systems have oppressed people in Ethiopia for thousands of years. Caste systems have oppressed people in India for thousands of years. Since the Veda came from the Brahmas out of the mountains of Iran. What, 3,000, 4,000 years ago? How long ago was that? 3,500 years ago. A caste system that have oppressed people. And they can't shake it. They can't even come to America and they can't shake it. I can take you to places in Southeast Asia and places in Indonesia. People live under a caste system, things that were imposed upon them since child, for generations. This is who you are. This is what you can do. This is what you can't do. This is who you, what you can be. And this, and it's a mentality about themselves. And the Word of God has come to set people free and liberate them so they don't have to live under that. But you know what? You yourself have been influenced by a caste system. You yourself have been influenced by an ideology and a philosophy and tradition of men that belongs to the culture of the United States of America that is a bunch of nonsense. What Father has for us. He's declared to us through his only begotten son Jesus. It's time that we understand that he's put a treasure on the inside of us, that the excellency of the glory and the power may be of God. You don't need to go looking for any other treasure. The treasure's on the inside of you. God will superly abundantly do above all that you can think or ask. I want you to listen to me. Because if you read this, like Daniel just read, wait a minute, man, we were supposed to be already set free. Jeremiah says 7 years, 70 years has come and passed. Wait a minute, I'm not going to stand here and tolerate this. I'm not going to leave it as though it's some sovereign. I read the sovereign will of God. I read what God elected. I'm going to find out what's going on here. We're going to bust this thing down right now. You start reading, wait a minute. Huh, I have a treasure on the inside of me. There's a power at work on the inside of me. Yeah. That God is super abundantly able to do above all that I can think or ask according to a power that is on inside of me. I don't have to wait for a power to come down from above. When I was born of the Spirit, the power of the living God came on the inside of me. When I was born from above, when I was born from again, when I was washed in the blood, when I was born of the Word, when I was born of the resurrection, a miracle work of grace came on the inside of me, a divine provision for all that I have needed. Would you believe that? Then you're not going to sit there and tolerate things that are different from that.
You don't get yourself up and moving around. Somebody breaks into your house, you're going to get yourself up and start moving around. You listen to me. Because you believe in your things. And you can see the enemy with your own eyes. And you understand the threat. Come on now. One day, all that is going on in your life will be put on a balance, as it were, and weighed. And God said, Godfather's going to say, look at how you fought for your stuff. Look how you fought for natural carnal things. Look how you were passionate about the stuff you were interested in. Look how much passion you put in to all those things that I declared about you and said that you could have them, that you could be, and paid such a high price for you to have them and be it. It's time for us to shake off the shackles that have held us back. It's time for us to bust out whatever prison we've been in. It's time for us to rise up to the responsibility and the occasion to show forth his praise. Amen. To show forth his glory, to begin to serve him with gladness of heart and with rejoicing. Hallelujah. Bande rache kata haya. Listen to me. Listen, when you begin to enjoy the presence of God, when you learn how to dance. One time I was looking at a woman, she's having some problems and issues. I said, you know how to dance, don't you? And she looked at me like, what? I said, you know how to dance, don't you? You learned how to dance sometime in your life, didn't you? She reluctantly, because we were in church, she reluctantly said, yeah. I said, you need to start dancing more.
You need to learn how to rejoice. You need to learn how to get happy. You need to learn how to keep yourself in the goodness of God when all these things of hell come try to impose themselves upon you, when all these things of lies come try to damn you, when all these things that Satan is speaking comes try to confine you, when all these things that men would declare concerning you would somehow oppress you. You need to start speaking forth the word of God. You need to get about excited about what the living word has declared over you. Amen. Listen to me now. Listen to me. The word of God's near you, in your mouth and in your heart. Jesus' purpose that we grow up into him, into all things. Listen, we're going to have to get real with this and quit making it a little memory verse. Quit making some little idea about something somebody could have had long ago or somebody can have somewhere in the future, and recognize Father's talking to you and you and you and you and you and me, us. And there's an invitation, and he's supplying all that we have need of according to his riches and glory as we connected with him properly. The Holy Spirit has brought all the, he said, riches of heaven. God gave to us the two greatest riches and treasure that he had, the two most important, closest things, dearest to himself. He gave to us his only begotten Son, who was eternally the Word hid in the bosom of the Father. He gave him for us. He who was rich became poor for our sake, that through his riches, through his poverty rather, we might be made rich. Do you understand the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ, the unsearchable riches of God, the unsearchable provision of God that you have right now, that whatever you ask, Father, will do it? Do you know how many times God says in his word, whatever you ask me, I will do it? There are seven great verses of scripture, starting in Matthew, ending in 1 John. Chapter 4, where the Lord describes to us that whatever we ask him, he'll do it. The highlighted one, Mark 11, 24. Whatever we ask him. The big one concerning the fruits that God has purposed to be revealed, manifest in our life, John 15, 16. You did not call me, I called you. You didn't choose me, I chose you. Hey, listen, the pressure's off now. It's the Father's idea. You didn't choose me. You get excited about this. When everything says you can't have it and you can't do it and you can't be it, you just say, God chose me. Hallelujah. And he ordained me to bring forth fruit. And this is the fruit that he elected me to have, that whatever I ask, he'll do it. Because there's a fruit of relationship that God wants seen. Listen to me. Listen to me. I'm not telling you no fairy tale. This isn't a rainbow Christianity. A rainbow, you can't have pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but you can never catch up to it. This is a living reality of the word of God. These are the promises of God, which are sure and steadfast. He is concerning all of his words, yes and amen. Amen. Hallelujah. This is what Father said. He wants the fruit of his relationship, this relationship, to be seen before all men. A great revival, a great Holy Ghost revival is going on right now in North Korea. The people of the Holy Ghost of the 1880s are on the rise again by the same Spirit of the Lord that moved that generation. He's moving them again. I'm telling you right now, in the year 2006, there was already over 5,000 people in one small group that I knew about just over the Yanji in North Korea. Listen to me. Sikando ropotaya siapa. Just let your hands towards heaven, baby. Let's just get a whole thought off of us right now in Jesus' name. Here we go. Amen. Hallelujah. All I got to do is be responsive. She go, he said there, and be stubborn, keep her hands down. But she lifted them up, and now she's feeling better. But back then, 2006, it was 5,000 in a community just across from Yanji, China, over in North Korea. I mean, it's an exploding power of the living God taking place in that nation right now. It's going to change the whole dynamics of things that are going on in North Korea. The God, by his Holy Spirit, is moving with his power right at this very moment. You don't want to be left out on the great things that God is doing. And let me just quickly tell you about that fruit that took place that resulted in those 5,000 people coming into the kingdom. 2006, and it's grown beyond that now. One woman from China went through the underground pipeline from China, the House Church of China, the Back to Jerusalem movement, into North Korea. She went out, and David and Geneva have been there, and they understand how things work. And really what the mode is when you're going in to unreached people groups, you go and work with them. You just do whatever they're doing. And she was out in the fields working with them. Very educated lady, you know, because many of the Chinese that have been born of the Spirit, baptized in the Holy Ghost, they just like Watchman Nee. Watchman Nee had his PhD in chemistry, and his wife had a
a PhD also in chemistry. And when they got born again, I mean, you know, they just give everything over to God, and they went full blown for the things of the kingdom. And so that's what's happening to some people in China. And so this woman, though she could have been some, she could be anything she wanted to be. 2006, she goes over, it's 2005, she goes over into China. And she goes out in the field and she starts working with them beginning at spring. She's just out there working side by side, just being kind to people, loving people. They can see something's different about her because she's always happy. She's got a sparkle of joy in her heart and in her eye. Hallelujah. There's not the sorrow. There's not the oppression. There's not the sadness. There's not the death seal of sin upon the face of depression and all that death brings. You listen to me. Everybody understands. I'm just emphasizing. Everybody understands the change in your countenance that God will bring into your life when you allow the Holy Ghost to surge through your emotions. She was one of them, baptized in the Holy Ghost. And at any rate, the monsoon came early. It was just about harvest time. They needed about 2 more weeks for the harvest to ripen. And any of you who are farmers, you understand how big 2 weeks is when it comes to the harvest. And it's about 2 weeks out, and here comes the monsoon. The whole harvest is going to be ruined. Here's what she does. For the first time, they all hear her. She stands up and screams out, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, in Korean. She screams out, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you, storm, dissipate. Cease to exist. And the storm immediately ceased to exist. Everybody's looking at her. There was over 200 people in the field. They're all looking at her. What are you? Yeah, see, there's a fruit that the Lord wants to have in our life. There's a price that we're going to have to pay. The price is this. Do it. Just do it. Do the word. Do it. Shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Just do it. Lift up your voice in praise and thanksgiving. Here's how you redeem the days, for the time is evil. Be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart, giving thanks always unto God. Hallelujah. People, the Spirit of the Lord wants you to move into a whole other dimension of allowing Him to flow through you, Him, the Holy Ghost. He's in you and with you. Jesus said, in that day, you shall know that the Father is in me and that I am in you. In that day, you should know when the Holy Ghost comes, because He was talking about the Holy Ghost coming in John 14, 17 through 21. And then 24 ultimately brings in that. And He simply says, I will come, my Father and I will come and make our dwelling with you. I'll manifest myself to you. These are things you can have right now. You decide that you don't want them. You prioritize them. You make them less than all the rest of your needs. When all of a sudden this becomes the most important thing for you and you live for this, you're going to have more understanding and more insight to the matter than Elijah had, because there's a greater realm of the power and the glory of God provided for you and I right now, because Jesus has baptized us in the Holy Ghost and fire. He's given us an unrestrained ability to know Him and walk with Him in oneness with Him. Just all of a sudden make that more important than anything else and watch what takes place. Dear people, listen to me. There's a flow that Father wants to come in your life. The temptation, the worldly lust, all the stuff that otherwise is going to come and fill the void, come and fill the vacuum in your life, because the surges of glory is not being realized. They won't have any more opportunities. Huh? The salesman will come, you'll say you filled up. Huh? He'll come with his goods, and you say you have room for nothing else because it's just overflowing. You're overflowing. I've been walking around the past couple of days singing the song. My cup is full and overflowing. My cup is full and overflowing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say overflowing. Overflowing.
Overflowing.
My cup is full and overflowing.
My cup is full and overflowing.
This is how you draw riches. This is how you draw riches. It's the same place from which you draw water from the well of salvation. How do you draw water from the well of salvation? Isaiah the prophet, Isaiah chapter 12, he said, with joy you shall draw water. Hallelujah. With joy you shall draw the supply of the Spirit. With joy you shall draw the supply that's being given to us and flowing right down from heaven. Right down right now from Christ Jesus, there is a river flowing. God wants this river of his divine provision to flow into your life, and then it will flow out of your life. And I'm telling you right now, all of the riches of his divine provision in every dimension of your life will begin to be realized. There is a river that brings forth an inspiration, that produces a motivation, that produces a supply, a divine explosion in the midst of your emotions, and carries you away into glory divine. Listen, you don't have to force your way. It's not, as it were, swimming upstream. No, God takes you and sweeps you away by his presence. All you got to do is learn how to enjoy his presence. Hallelujah. Listen, one last thing. I just want you to hear this. This is what I've experienced. This is what every man of God I've ever known that's ever done anything in God has experienced, and every woman I've ever known in God has experienced. I have never experienced the presence of God complaining and murmuring and telling God how bad I am and how awful things are. It just gets worse. I only experience the presence of God in an overwhelming way when, no matter what situation I find myself in, I'm just rejoicing and giving thanks and blessing him for who he is. And let me just tell you one thing. I have discovered that when the opposition is oppressed upon me and I have every reason to complain and every reason to say those other things, but yet I lift up my voice and I exalt Christ Jesus above all that other stuff, that's when the presence of God manifested in my life is greater than at any other time. It's a sacrifice of praise. I'm going to bring it to him. I'm going to exalt him. Hallelujah. I'm not going to exalt some little stuff, some bank account, some person's opinion of me, some job issue, some other thing in this world. Give me a break. A little demi. They're not even qualified to be demigods. They're stick gods. They're gods of imagination. They're nothingness. Oh, I have a picture in my office. The picture is of Pop Seymour. Because of the caste system in the United States of America, because of the evilness of men's heart, Pop Seymour so wanted to go to Bible school in Kansas where they were teaching about the Holy Ghost. But because they were all segregated and everything, they made Pop Seymour sit out on the porch. I've got a picture of Pop Seymour, painted a picture of Pop Seymour sitting out on the porch, just a little three-step up porch into the church house. And he sat out there in the bad weather and the rain. He sat out there in the bad weather in the wintertime. And he sat there with his ear up to the door because they cracked it for him, bless their hearts, to hear as they preached about the Holy Ghost. He didn't walk away and say, man, those guys knew about the Holy Ghost. They knew, loved God. They let me in there. No, he said, these men know something about God, and I want to learn it. And he kept a good attitude about the whole thing. Pop Seymour did something that none of them did. God took him and promoted him into a place because he was willing to seek something that only God had, that they were talking about, that he wanted more with his heart than they wanted with their heart. They had the degrees, and they had the position, and they had the right-of-ways, and they had the opinions, but he had the passion in the heart. He came to Los Angeles on April 9th, 1906. God took Pop Seymour, a one-eyed black man, and changed the whole expression of the church throughout the world. One man, one little old no account black man who's not worthy to come inside because of segregation. He's got to sit out on the porch in the bad weather, who never had a bad attitude, who never lost his vision, never lost his purpose in God, but all of a sudden began to understand who he was, defined by him, by Jesus Christ. He changed. A revival at the Apostatarianiata of the Pentecostal outpouring took place right up here on Azusa Street, Pasadena, California. Hallelujah. People, all you got to do is keep a good attitude. All you got to do is get out of what you think about yourself and what everybody wants to tell you about yourself and what everybody tries to impose upon you, men and devils. Huh? Start believing what God says. Quit making all those things that happened to you in the past so important. Look at what God has purposed for you right now, at this moment, at this second, at this time. The fire of God is here. The presence of the Holy Ghost is here. The glory of Jesus is here. The great outpouring of His Spirit here. The great divine empowering is here. The great goodness of the Almighty God is here to touch you, to change you, to strengthen you, to empower you, to give you out of His abundance. Freely He gives you all things to enjoy. Out of His abundance, He gives you this abundant life. He withholds nothing of Himself and says, come on, be in me and I'll be in you. Come stand up here in this place. Come, take your seat with me. Come rule, reign with me right now. You, every one of you, if you would just believe the report that God has given of His only begotten Son, if you just believe what God has said about you, everything will begin to change in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence. Thank you, Holy Spirit, you're the one that breaks the yoke. Hallelujah. Everybody would just stand with me. Thank you, Father, for the anointing. Hallelujah. 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 Sitandoro sikete yarama naseri. Sitandoro sikine le basi prebopando yi praia. Lerene menete pu'ula. Limende le buto manaseya. Somebody said, what's the value of the language of the Spirit? Teaches you how to talk different. It will cause you to arise to the excellence of the speech of Almighty God. It will form your tongue into the pen of a ready writer so that you may make known those counsels that are in the heart and mind of the Father. Somebody says, what value is in the rushing rivers of extreme joy? Oh, God is able now to take and move by His force and by His power through the very essence of your life and cause you to understand how to have access into a realm that nothing can match in this world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So many people have tried to go and sell all that they have to obtain the pearl of great price, but they never saw the pearl. And the Holy Ghost has come to show you the pearl. So many people have tried to go and sell all that they have that they might buy the field in which was hid a treasure, but they never saw the treasure. And so in sacrifice and with reluctance and with religious drudgery, they press along. Not knowing this life in Jesus, this relationship that He has provided for us through His only begotten Son. This night, let these things be settled for you. This night, Jesus is calling you. He's calling you into greatness. I'm headed someplace, just up the way a little ways. Yeah, I can see the lights of the celestial city. Just up the ways a little ways. Just up around the corner there. You and I are about to break through into another dimension of reality. We're about to step out of this world into another world. There's probably not a single person in this place that will be alive 100 years from now. It has nothing to do with the end of the world. It has to do with the appointed time that is placed upon your life. Your life is, as it were, an hourglass set upon it. The time is fast slipping away. Don't let your life be consumed with the deceptions and with the lies and the things that every man knows in his heart will not last. It's time to turn your life over to the one who said, I am the truth, I am the way, I am the life. No man comes to the Father lest he comes by me. I've come that you might have life. I've come that you might have it more abundantly. All that came before me were thieves and robbers and liars. I said before you this day an entrance, the Lord says. In this place of the unlimited provision of God, who's invited us to come and grow up into Him. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15. To grow up into Him. into all things, to grow up into the head, Christ Jesus, who is supplying us with the ability to grow. And as we receive the supply, there's a supply flowing out of us to each other. And out of this supply, we begin to build up ourselves and edify ourselves. We begin to grow together in this divine love of God. Hallelujah. This is a realm. Listen to me. This is the realm. This is the realm of the moving of God, the revival of God, the people of God being seen in the earth, the moving of the Holy Ghost, the moving of the people of the Holy Ghost, the moving of the heavenly people from the earth. When we turn back our hearts to the Lord individually to make those things which are most valuable, valuable to us, when we begin to believe His word, and then we turn back our hearts to God collectively, we recognize this is your church, Pops. This belongs to you, Lord Jesus. And nobody has a right to have their opinions, put their hands on it, mess with it, sit around and talk about this thing, that thing, the other thing, how they feel abused, misused, uncalculated, whatever, marginalized. It's His church. It's His church. Hands off, it's His church. It don't belong to you. It belongs to the governorship of the Holy Ghost, and you need to submit your attitudes and what you believe and think about it and say, Lord, well, what do you see? How do you want? What adjustments do you want me to make? God, the Holy Ghost steps in and says, listen, I want things to be changed. You go, hey, now hands off, you interrupt him. I can't believe you treat me like that. What? Treat you like what? Give you the opportunity to grow up in Him and who is the head and all things, begin to flow and operate in the divine power and get out of whatever it is you're doing. Come on, you listen to me. The arrogance of men have got to cease. The arrogance of men, the haughtiness of men, to think they got it right. It's nuts, isn't it? The light's shining. The light's shining in a dark place. If you'll take heed unto the word of God, it says a light shining in a dark place. You begin to hear His audible voice. Come on, baby, we're going to go after this, aren't we? We're going to go after this. The United States of America will once again burn in the glory and the presence of the living God. And it's going to be greater than things in the past. It's going to be greater than things in the past. When the power of the Holy Ghost was moving, the bad things that America is known for wasn't happening. It's when men turn their hearts away from God and begin to seek their own things that the bad things begin to take place. Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jacqueline, Zoe, Clara. Are you willing to let God take your life and use you to change the nation? You wouldn't just totally give yourself over? Alyssa, Annalyn, Brittany, Martha, Anna, Elizabeth, Allie, Kate, Ruth, Summer, Daniel, Mom, you, every one of you. How much do you need to be in control? How much do you need to have your way and your ideas? How much are you willing to let yourself be molded and shaped by God every second, every minute? If you begin to walk with God second by second, it'll turn into minute by minute. It'll go from glory from second to glory from minute to minute. Then it'll go from glory to hour, then it'll go from glory from day to day, and then from week to week, and then month to month, and then year to year. Next thing you know, you'll find yourself standing before the presence of the Lord, and it'll all be over.
Amen.
And He'll look at you and say, thank you for allowing me to live. Thank you for not doing it your own way, being arrogant. Demanding. This is what I believe we should do. That is not in me. Better not be in you. This is sacred ground to me. It's holy ground. Your lives are sacred. You put the tool of man upon it. As soon as I begin to even sense that somebody's putting the tool of man on something, I'm like, stop that thing. Shut that down. They have no idea what they're doing. No idea. You ruin lives. You destroy people. Just take them away from Father and bring them unto yourself. Not us. We're going to let the glorious light of the gospel shine through our lives. Amen. Every one of us in this place. Every one of you. 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 Ethiopia, you stepping into the glory. Come on now, girl. You stepping into the glory. You stepping into the glory. You stepping into the glory. You belong to Jesus. Your family back in Ethiopia belongs to Jesus. Your family here belongs to Jesus. Let heaven's glory flow through you. Ethiopia.
Jesus. Jesus. Now, Jesus.
You don't want the American dream. You want the heavenly vision.
Yes.
I love Ethiopia. I love all of Africa. In fact, I even love Zambia with all the malaria. Botswana, Mozambique, Rwanda, the Congo, Liberia, Kenya, Nigeria, Chad, the Sudan. You know why I love it? Why I love the nation so much? Because Christ Jesus loves the nation so much. Father wants to set you on fire with His glory, so overwhelm you with His presence, so bring you into a place of relationship with Him that you no longer exist anymore, you no longer live, and the Spirit of the Living God has free course through your life.
Always happens about that time, doesn't it?
Jesus. Just receive right now. Just set your hands towards Him.
Just be encouraged, Ellie. Be encouraged. Be encouraged, honey.
Huh? Just be encouraged. Oh, so the kingdom of my soul is to have the Christian. If you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost, get baptized right now.
Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the anointing, the Holy Ghost. It begins to surge to your daughter, a divine power to begin to be used by you in a way that supersedes anything that she's known up to this moment in time. That your glory, that which only you can do, that not the thoughts of men nor thinking nor ideas can produce, but a heart set on you, a life filled with you, results in. Zaprakataya. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for the anointing.
Thank you, Father, for the wisdom, for the leadership and the guidance as Daniel and Summer step into Bonanza. Hallelujah. And see those things more clearly that you would desire to do there. You know, I was telling Daniel and Summer earlier, I don't remember if it was today or yesterday, whatever, that this mindset that people have placed upon the outpouring of the Holy Ghost and what would be known as the Pentecostal movement, it's got to be changed. Because it's not about all the hooping and the hollering and this and that. It's about enjoying the presence of God. It's about learning to enjoy the presence of God. It's about learning to interact with Jesus and there being so filled up that the explosions of the Holy Ghost begin to be activated on the inside of our spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Tonight, if there's anybody in the place, you're uncertain as to whether or not your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You're uncertain as to whether or not the Spirit of the Lord has come upon you and changed you into a new person, made a new creation out of you, made you part of a new race. Those who are purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ and born of the Spirit. Brought us into a place where we called the church a holy nation, a royal priesthood. I can't help it, all the misrepresentation. I'm talking about the things that God has described and He's explained and declared through His only begotten Son, Jesus. Tonight, if you're uncertain, God wants you to be certain. Jesus wants you to be certain. He wants you to recognize that if you call upon the name of the Lord, if you call upon His name, when we say Lord, we're talking about God. That is the name that we use for God. It's set apart as a name that describes who God is. He tells us He'll come and deliver us. He says, with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. With the heart, man believes unto righteousness. And He wants to put that word in your heart and in your mouth right now, where you know, if there's anybody in this place you doubt your salvation, you doubt, you don't know whether or not you're right with God. Somehow you're uncertain about where you would stand if you were to be called up into His presence at this moment in time to give an account for your life. You're uncertain. God has purposed to make you certain. He wants to drive the doubt away. He wants to drive the uncertainty away. He wants to cause you to understand that now your whole life's in Him. Begin to experience the beauty and the splendor and the glory that produces. Walking around going, "Ooh, I'm in God. God's in me." It's cause for rejoicing. Jesus said, "Don't rejoice that the devils are subject to you through my name, but that your name is written in heaven." It's cause for rejoicing. Jesus calls for rejoice. It's what makes me rejoice all the time. It's an act of faith of participating with God. Is, as far as I'm concerned, just continues to go on a sealing the deal. Huh? Come on, think about it. I don't care what thing you're going through. All of a sudden, you just begin to think about your name's written back in the Lamb's Book of Life. And Jesus said, they're rejoicing this. You start, whoop. You're participating with faith. You're participating with God. Says, you're cooperating with the Holy Ghost. And every time you cooperate with the Holy Ghost, it gets bigger in your life. Not that He grows, but that you grow, and in growing, you allow Him to be more fully revealed. Praise God, Caleb. You're looking good tonight, man. You're looking like Caleb tonight, and not like one of the other doubters in the house of Israel. You're looking like a Holy Ghost Caleb, a man that's going to take that mountain. Come on, man. Come on now. Come on, man. Guys, get around the table, start praying in the Holy Ghost more. 5 minutes of family praying in the Holy Ghost is powerhouse. Loving on each other and being happy about being around each other. Praise God. We had a glorious Thanksgiving time. It'd have been better if Joshua and Allie and babies were there, but boy, didn't we have an amazing time? We had a glorious time. Just sitting around in the hoochapai and the fellowship and the glory of the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. I love fellowshipping with the things of the Spirit. Fellowshipping with the things that God has for us. That should be the excitement of church. That's why we're glad when they said unto us, let's go to the house of the Lord. Because they're going to be singing. They're going to be dancing. It's going to be like going up on to the Mount Zion. It's going to be going up into the presence of the living God. People come in with all sad and sorrowful and downbeat. You didn't go to heaven. You went to hell. You know what I'm saying? You're in some other kind of something or other. You listen to me. It's time you get your heart and your affections in heaven. It's time you recognize who you're going to go meet with, what you're going to go do. It should be an elation to you. Hallelujah. Now, I just want you to receive right now in Jesus' name. I want you to receive the blessings God has for you so you can be blessed. I want you to be filled up tonight right now with Jesus so you can be filled up tomorrow too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amy, come here. Amy Scott, come here. Let your hands up towards him. Ask him what you want. Ask him what you would. Ask him. What do you want? What do you want? He's there to give you whatever you ask. It's a beautiful thing to him when we say, Lord Jesus, I want you. I have him, but I want him. See, Paul was able to say, listen to this. Paul was able to say, Romans 15:19, he was able to say, I fully preached the gospel from Jerusalem to Illyricum, the signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost. He fully preached the gospel. Years later, he said that I may know him. I just want Jesus, that I may win him. He said, I've suffered the loss of all things. This is what he said to the church of Philippi. Let me say this first. He says, I've suffered the loss of all things for Jesus. And I count it but dung, that I may win him.
Win him. Win. Win him.
What kind of doctrine do you have, Paul? That I may win him. As though he's romancing him and wants to know him and see him. Say, the same cry is going on in Moses' heart, that I may see you more. I want to see you. I want to see you as in all the fullness of your glory and the unlimited dimensions of your power and your eternalness. He says to the church at Philippi that I may know him. I'm going to tell you right now. I believe that so moves Christ Jesus, it moves him to tears. I believe it moves him to the affection of love to tears when that kind of affection is going on in life. When there's been a life of service, a life of consecration, and you're still saying, Lord, that I may know you. I'm telling you, people, I'm talking to you about an entrance made ministered to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of the dear Son. I'm talking to you about how to go in a glorious, more deeper, more unlimited manner. That I may know him, the power of his resurrection. That I may know him, the fellowship of his suffering. See people burn out and say, I'm tired. I'm tired. I'm tired of getting beat up. Paul's going, that I may know him, the fellowship of his suffering. And look how much he's been beat up. Shipwrecked. Beaten 3 times. 3 times in the deep. Outcast, rejected. Persecuted from city to city. Read the list. Chapter 12. Rabasikia. Of Corinthians. He's saying that I may know him in the fellowship of his suffering. You know what the sufferings of Jesus was? The rejection of men. That comes as a consequence of only following to do the will of the Father. That I may know him in the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. That if I too might by any means possible obtain the resurrection of the dead. That's why he said, those who seek glory and glory, to them be immortality and life. Hey? Those who seek honor and glory. What do you want? Huh? What do you want? What do you want? Enjoy His presence. Here's what the Lord says. He says, submit to my will. His will is unmistakable. You know that? His will is unmistakable. Submit to.
Right now, just be filled. Be filled. Be filled. Be filled.
Be filled.
Don't disconnect. Connect.
People, when the supply is not coming to you like Father's ordained, it's because someplace you disconnected. Somebody said, what am I supposed to do? Just repent. And reconnect. Disconnect from your will and connect with Father's. Amen?
Amen.
Disconnect from all the stuff that would harass you and connect with Him. Let the water courses of heaven course through you. Right now. Right now. Right now, this heartache, this hurt,
and headache.
Well, I'm going to deal with the heartache, okay? Because a headache is nothing. But we'll get that too. The heartache, the hurt, the disappointment, and the discouragement has nothing whatsoever to do with the will of the Father. It's nothing whatsoever to do with the ministry of the Holy Spirit. It has nothing whatsoever to do with your ability to grow and mature in Him. So right now, just cast it from you. Cast it from you. Cast it from you. Somebody said, well, how do I do that? Just say, Lord, forgive me for being stupid.
Lord, forgive me for being stupid.
Thank you for your wisdom. Lord, thank you for your wisdom.
Thank you for your wisdom.
So I can walk in you. So I can walk in.
So I can walk in.
Live in you.
Live in
you. So be filled right now. Be filled. Just be filled. Be filled. Won't last a day of Patora. Be filled. Be filled. Be filled. Look at me. Be filled. Healed. Jesus. Jesus. Headache go away. Sickness go in Jesus' name. Go from me now. Dance around a little bit.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Honestly, all you need to do is dance a little more.
It's really pretty simple. Praise God.
Find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. We are so glad you're in the house. If you want prayer tonight for anything, we're here to pray with you and for you. We know God will touch you. We know His love will overwhelm you. Praise the name of Jesus. Worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Bring into His house that offering of praise and thanksgiving. Once again, if anybody needs prayer for anything, sick in your body, harassed, tormented in any way, just need fresh touch from heaven. We're here to pray with you and for you. God's going to touch you, overwhelm you with His goodness.
Woo! Hallelujah. Woo-hoo. Thank you, Jesus. Hamasaya. Hamasaya hate. The fire. The fire. The outpouring of the glory of heaven. In Jesus' name. Be strengthened by the power of the Holy Ghost. More fully yield yourself to Him, to His way, to His movings, to His riches.
I felt like this morning when I was preaching, we were talking about the prayer of consecration, and I just wanted to consecrate my life to pray what to do God's will. Like I needed to say that. I know God will answer that.
Probably, thank you. Very simple.
Yeah.
And it's so easy and it's so wonderful. Because it's about enjoying His presence. Amen. Praise and thanksgiving. Hey?
Amen.
Yes. In Jesus' name.
Spirit of the Lord's right here to touch you. He's right here to feel you.
Supply to you all that you have need of. He's going to supply to you according to His riches and glory. An unsearchable riches. From the crown of your head, O daughter of the Lord, be in doubt no more, but be of a understanding and believing heart. Hallelujah. To enjoy all the things of heaven, to enjoy this riches of His fellowship, this riches of His presence, this riches of His favor. Thank you, Jesus. From the crown of your head, soles of your feet. Stokota masturbate. Be strengthened in your body, in your spirit. What do you want us to pray with you for? Sister, prayer and praise. I'm telling you. And it's just good. We learn to train our response. Yeah. How about we learn to train our emotion and response to the river right there in Southern Lily. And it's activated with the praise. Because because with joy we draw water out of the river, out of the belly, out of the supply of the Spirit, the riches right out of the treasure. That's the well of salvation there, you see. That's where the treasure is on the inside of you. And with joy, and sometimes joy don't come easy. Huh? Joy comes by way of rejoicing. Just thank you, Lord. Thank you for healthy, screaming kids that aren't sitting paralyzed in the hospital somewhere on a ventilator. Sometimes we just got to understand. We've got to recognize the blessing we have in the midst of the problem. Lord, help me to appreciate and enjoy every moment that I have right now, because it's not going to be many years and they're going to be gone. We're not going to see them. It's going to be an event on Thanksgiving and Christmas when they come over. And then we're going to think about all those days of frustration that could have been days of celebration. Yeah. Wisdom allows us to see in the future that we may be able to more fully appreciate the present. Yeah. So, Father, we thank you for wisdom. Hallelujah. Wisdom. Somebody said the wisdom of Solomon and the patience of Job is what it takes. But you know what? God's given us that. God's given you that. Nicole. He's giving you a call from off the altar. Hallelujah. He's giving you the glory of his presence. Enjoy it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Whatever you want, God give to you. Thank you for the passport. Adostai, in the most. Come. Passport, come. Provision, come. Thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you for blessing Martha. Bless her. Give her the desires of her heart. Give her the desires of her heart. Jesus. Ako je šeprano na sete I prast. Malando ste prene kitando lo puti. Strong and mighty. Strong and mighty and gone. Strong and mighty in God. Mighty in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Strong in his strength. By the Spirit of the Lord, the strength of you. You may rise up. Put 1,000 to fight. Then you grab a hold of Annalyn. Then you both put 10,000 to fight. Ah, Satan. It's about this. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Say, Lord, I know that you are my shield and my exceeding great reward. And I'm the place where you dwell. La Torre Se. Jesus, Jesus, walk around all day and just prophesy of yourself and declare the word of God and say, Jesus Christ dwells and lives on the inside of me. I'm dead and my life is hid with God in Christ. What a beautiful place. You need to, You walk around, you start declaring these things, suddenly become aware of them. Suddenly you go, whoa. Almighty God's walking on the inside of me, living on the inside of me. Beristando ki ashe, ibranase. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Ha! Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the word of faith that is right here in the heart and in the mouth of Adam, that he may do it. That he may do all that you said and all that you commanded and have all that you freely given and supplied. Nothing stands in the way. Nothing can prevent the goodness of God. Nothing can prevent that which Father has ordained and commanded. Just begin to lift up your head and begin to lift up your hands and begin to rejoice and begin to shout for joy and begin to just celebrate the fact that it is so simple and that it is not difficult, that you call and he answered. Hallelujah. 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 That you cried out and he responded. That you requested and he gave to you that which you asked for. Make it so simple and make it so easy. Let praise find its place in your life. Let praise find its place continually in you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. And as you praise him, and as you worship him, and as you celebrate all that he has said and all that he has declared, calling the report of the Lord that which you believe, then all that he has supplied, and all the provision that you need for your spirit and for your soul and for your body, you realize it'll be there. It'll be right there. And you'll discover how easy it is. You'll say, my, this is so easy. That even the fool cannot err therein. The one void of understanding and knowledge cannot miss it. For this is what the Lord has said. For this is what the Lord has spoken. These things are yours right now. They're yours. Hallelujah. So you just start dancing around, celebrating the goodness of God. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. All that he has supplied is yours. All that he has freely given, it's yours. Hallelujah. Praise the name. Kotara Masekani. Kando Kobosaba. Bulemang deste perotoshi. Abakeya. Low stay Maratani. Low stay Bremandeshi. Remande Oshipande Osha. The Lord's not left you out of any good thing. He doesn't need, look at me, he doesn't need your help. He just wants you to let him be God. He wants to show you how wonderful he is, how much he loves you. How wonderful he is as a father who cares so much that he gives to his good gifts. He gives the Holy Ghost to those who ask. Jesus said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your Father in heaven give the Holy Ghost to them that ask? Thank you, Jesus, for this faith. Thank you, Jesus, for this anointing. Thank you, Jesus, for the revelation of the right way, your way, the highway of heaven. Just let your hands towards heaven. Just let your hands towards heaven. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Holiness unto the Lord. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Every part of you belonging to that which Christ Jesus has redeemed. Every part of you belonging to the Lord. Your thoughts, your desires, your affections, in Jesus' name. Be filled. Be filled. Be filled with heaven's glory. Be filled with heaven's joy. Be filled with heaven's joy. Let the rivers of the Spirit of the Lord find free course in you. Let the glory of heaven overwhelm you. Let the things of the Spirit of God take hold of you. Let Him show you the reality of all that Jesus purchased at Calvary. All that He brought forth when He raised, when Father raised Jesus from the dead and set Him at His own right hand. When He poured out His Spirit upon all flesh. Life begin in men. Life begin in men. Life begins in men the day the Spirit of the Lord comes in. Life begins in men the day the Spirit of the Lord comes in. Jesus. Mandraste. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you take a young woman's heart, surrender to you to serve you in any way you desired on the mission field or wherever, and you fulfill those things, oh God. Fulfill them. Fulfill them. Yeah? Yes. Yeah. Hallelujah. Father, we pray that all Asia laughs for the joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just do this. Hallelujah. Just stay right there. Just learn how to flow in the joy of the Holy Ghost all the time. He will fill you there. He will fill you there. He will supply to you there. See, with joy you draw water from the well of salvation and draw the riches that are there in Christ Jesus. And He said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. You draw the wealth right out of the treasure that He's placed on the inside of you. Yeah. Yes. Monje rest. Yep. Yeah. In Jesus' name. What is wrong with you? Doesn't look like there's much wrong with you. What you need? What you want? Huh? What you want? Jesus. What you want? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. What you want? Jesus. What you want? What you want? What do you want? Jesus walked up to the man at the pool and He said, would you be healed? He came to others and He said, what would you that I do for you? What do you want me to do for you? What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? So many people have many wants. Big part of the problem. Because all those other wants are really distractions. And when the floodlight of reality sets upon your soul, suddenly you realize it disappears. They dissipate. They become meaningless. In the light of eternity, what's really valuable stands there apparent and unmovable and untouchable in the light of eternity. See? That's where reality stands up, in the light of eternity. Jesus. Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Father, I thank you for wisdom that settles upon Brooke's life, that she can realize that the ways of the world have no life in it, have no value in it, have no hope in it, have no provision, have no fulfillment in it, but rather is death and destruction, and that you call out to her to come and live her life to the fullness, to live her life to the fullest in you. She's filled with your fullness. Just think about it. You have the right and privilege to pursue every dimension of the fullness of God. And it all comes down to the dictates of your desires. Tonight, if you are willing to allow the Holy Spirit to speak truth into your life and remove out all those other desires to where that you have one desire and you exalt the things of the kingdom of God and His purpose for your life, His word, His will above all things, and you begin to passionately pursue that opportunity which He's made available to you, it won't be long. It won't be long. And whole new vistas, as it were. Vista views in God would begin to be revealed to you. Dimensions of joy that you never experienced. You know, tomorrow you got, tonight even, you can look forward to saying, hey, you know, I want to touch a realm of joy I've never touched before. Yeah. Do you know that there's realms of joy you've never touched before? There are realms of peace you've never touched before. There's realms of love. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge results in you being filled with all the fullness of God. There's dimensions of love where you can grow in love. Where you can increase with the increase of God. Literally grow with the growth of God. Pretty radical scripture, isn't it? That's what I want. That's what tomorrow means to me. My heart is fixed. My heart's fixed. I'm pursuing heavenly vision. I'm a labor for the master from the dawn till setting sun. We're going to go after greatness in God. We're going to set our hand once again to the work of the ministry. We're going to move in faith, see things break open. See the miracle supply of that which we're building right now, that God has finally brought us to another phase in what we're doing to create sustainability for missions. So people can begin to understand, right now you can begin to understand exactly what we're doing, or why we talk about business needing to serve ministry rather than the other way around, why we're talking about the way, what we need, the things that we need to create sustainability within third world missions, underdeveloped poor nations missions. You can begin to handle it. Touch it. Don't stand there and look at it. Get it. And stand there and look. Do it. Do it. Take out the banner and do it. Go with it. You can go with it. Father's looking at you. He sees what you do with your opportunities that He provides for you. He sees how important they are to you. He knows everybody that emails me and says, what can I do? He knows everybody, of course, that says to Him, Lord, what can I do? Show me what to do. How can I become more available? If you heard the Lord, He'd say, go talk to the pastor. Did you know that? So now I just helped you understand exactly what Papa would say. Because that's what He's going to say. because he's placed you in the midst of a church to hear his voice and connect with him and grow and mature with him through that supply which he's given. If you don't believe that, you're never going to grow. If something discourages you or distracts you from that, it's taking you out. You'll never move forward. Many people have been taken out. They can't move forward because they don't realize that's true. They don't know how to connect with the church. Thus, they can't connect with the supply that comes from heaven. It's true. I don't magnify my office. I magnify the office which he's established. I'm just trying to help you understand how you're going to connect with God, how you're going to move forward. Really just think about it. What it is that you have to do full-time in ministry right now? You have a full-time ministry opportunity. You have full-time ministry responsibility. Right wherever you're at, right in your job, right in the context of your life, right now. It's already been there. You don't have to go looking elsewhere. If you go looking elsewhere, right over there and over here, and all the time it's been right in front of you. Let the Spirit of the Lord give you wisdom. Thank you, Jesus. I mean, I'm just believing, Lord, that the next time that there is an opportunity like there was in Afghanistan, where I personally know people who sit upon the provisional government board of a nation, when one government has been toppled, waiting for a new government to be elected, and I know two people of the six or seven that's on the provisional board, that I have $100 million to say, here's $50 million for you, for the government, and we're going to go and take all the orphans. And we're going to take all the old people and the refugees, and we're going to build structure for them, housing for them. Yes. And you reach a nation.
Yes.
So the opportunity wasn't available 3 years after the war began. You could have done it. Can't do it now. Could have done it then. How are you going to do that? What are you doing right now? Think about it. I want you to understand. God's given you an opportunity through this ministry to reach the nations of the earth. What are you doing with it? I want you to understand this. I'm not condemning anybody. I'm not harassing anybody. I'm challenging you. God, you can sit around and pray all you want. If you don't look at what's in front of you, you know what? There's a problem, mental problem. And Father wants to give you a fix for that mental problem right now. He wants to give you wisdom. You know, wisdom is insight, ability to see. Father's giving you a tool and a provision to opt in to taking the nations of the world. What are you going to do with it? Are you going to sit back and look at it and go, wow, that's really interesting? You know, it's like one person said, well, I'm just going to pray that you have the strength of 10 oxen. Okay. Fine, watch me work. While you go in your prayer closet and pray that God uses you. Nonsense. You ain't going to ever be used. Because you had opportunities right, left, and center within the context of where God placed you, and you didn't understand the value of it. You did your own thing. Somebody said, well, we're just not here to do your thing. Well, I'm not doing my thing. I'm doing the kingdom of God thing.
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
So we pray in Jesus' name you'll grab a hold of it.
Yes.
Come go with us.
Thank you.
Come go with us. Somebody said, I don't understand. That's unimaginable. There's a Facebook. There's a website. There's a church meeting. There's a Bible. There's somebody talking to you for 10 years. I'm sorry. There's some serious issues going on, right?
Yes.
And we're buying that thing right now.
Amen.
And then Daniel's got a flyer for most of you tonight. You can just give them to some people and hand it out. Let Father use you.
Amen.
Father use you.
Yes.
I got one thing I want to say tonight in closing. I'm still going to pray for the people standing there. I didn't forget about them. The Lord says if you don't understand how to be faithful with unrighteous mammon, you understand how to be faithful with the financial realms of provision that comes to you. Who then shall commit unto you the true riches? I believe that by and large, God's people have not stepped in to all the wealth and provision that Father has for us, the war chest that Father has for us to do things like I described in Afghanistan. Because they don't have the hearts to take and handle the riches. Their hearts should be changed. They become puffed up, prideful, arrogant. Their hearts should be turned away from God. I have friends of mine in China say, well, none of our people from China can, none of our leaders from China can come to America because they'd all be ruined. Every one of them. I said, really? Come on. 100%? 100%. They don't know how to handle it. I said, come on, man. You just need to be taught different. And, you know, and I think that this is the case with many people, even in America, Western world. We want the Lord to be able to do what he needs to do in our life, that we can become stewards of the finances, and every single penny is about the kingdom of God. It's not about our own stuff. I don't spend money on me. It is rare that I spend money on me. My money is about the kingdom of God. How do we move forward? How do we get there? How do we take that next step? I mean, people around me know this. And I'm just telling you, because I'm following Jesus. I know, it's like a preacher said to me recently, I know you're going to heaven. And I know I'm going to heaven too. I know I'm on the right path. I know I'm following Jesus. Because I'm doing exactly what the Word of God says to do. Silver and gold have I none. I am right now, tomorrow, signing a piece of paper that will take me into a place where I'm divested of all earthly riches and it belongs to another governing body. I'm divested of all. Hallelujah. Silver and gold have I none. I'll be a part of seeing the thing grow and mature to a place that finances are properly handled in the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
And we're going to empower those around us who are connected with us and hooked up with us, and it's been tried and proven and evaluated, and love is there and it's established, and there's no wavering about it, there's no question marks about it. It's not a question mark in one eye and an exclamation mark in the other. It's all in. It's not a distant look of uncertainty. It's like, command ye me as soldiers. And you just see the private arguing with the general. It ain't going to happen. The interface never takes place. Can you see the corpsman arguing with the sergeant? Probably, but he's going to get smacked. Because he's going to mess up. Right? Can you see him arguing with the captain? He ain't going to get it. He ain't going to get there. You can't pass the lieutenant. Are you with me? God's got an army. He's got an army of people who are learning how to be highly disciplined, highly submitted, and committed to the authority, the captain of our salvation. I never got to that part in the message tonight. What I hear the Spirit of the Lord say, are you part of an army? Are you just your own combat unit? Special forces. You and you. God's got an army. Under the command and direction of the Holy Ghost. And there are assignments. There are assignments that are given. Talked a bit about that this morning. There are assignments that are given. People want to compare themselves. Peter will say, John, what about him? What about John? Jesus says, forget about him. You follow me. And so you're here in this ministry, and we want you to be all in. We want you to let God help you to understand how to be all in what we're doing. And if you're not, you need to get that fixed. You've got to find out what's wrong, what's going on in the side of your heart that you can't be all in on what's going on here. Because that means you're disjointed. You're disconnected. There's a trust problem. There's a love problem. There's a relationship problem. Supply can't come to you. Read it. I didn't get to all of it tonight in Ephesians chapter 4. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's a harassing, interfering spirit, a division. You rise up against the thing and you take hold of the Word of God and the Spirit of God. And you say, that isn't allowed in my life. That doesn't look like the Word. That doesn't look like the Holy Ghost, and I'm not going to allow it. I'm going this thing. Amen. Amen. How many of you just know that the children in the house ought to be submitted to their parents? You just know that. How many of you know that the parents ought to be submitted to the children? Just find out what the three-year-old wants. Make sure you're in submission to her. Come on now. The Lord give you understanding. Amen. In all things. Praise God. Father said to give us the wealth and the supply of all that he has. But we've got to obey him. We've got to participate with him. We've got to do what he's doing. You know what he's doing? He's going to go after Kashmir. You know what he's doing? He's going to go after the lost and the hurting and the dying and the suffering. You know what he's doing? He's going to go after... Yes, I believe that the people of God need to be encouraged. But how about the people who have never heard one time? I'm ready to go to Kashmir. I'm prepped to go to Kashmir. We're going to go ahead and get this job done in Havana, Cuba. February, March, looks like it's set for February, March right now. And get this job done in Havana, Cuba. And then we're targeting Kashmir. We're going after, the Lord gave me a strategy almost 4 years ago for Kashmir. 3.5 years ago. Well, it's almost 4 years ago now. Huh, baby, where you at? 4 years ago. Right? About four. And then we're ready. We need more laborers. We need more help. Let me know what God has put in your hand to make great wealth. Let me know. Because I've already told you what the Lord's placed in my hand. I'm happy to support you. Just let me know because I don't understand. You with me? Because we, listen, I don't believe that what Father is going to do and what we, the resources we have in the nations of the earth, both financial and human resources, are going to come through offering baskets and from the church only. It's going to come through insights and divine wisdom that Father gives and from the human resources that are raised up among those who are lost right now in those nations.
Amen. That's good.
Because when we can begin to impact the old people, take in the old people and the orphans, and we begin, you take orphans from 3 years old to 12 years old, what are they going to look like 10 years from now? Raised properly. How much money does that take? How much finance does it? You tell me how you're doing it. Because I'm living it. I'm telling you right now. We living it. We will get up early in the morning and we will live it all day long. We're going to live it. Literally, we will live this. We will live it. We live it every day. Don't just be untouched to the depths of your emotions over what's going on, because it's an opportunity that you're going to give an account for. Participate.
Yes.
I want you to participate. I want you to be a part of it. I want you to be a part of what God is doing with us. Yes. We don't want you to be left out. We're giving everybody an opportunity to participate. We don't always have opportunities in which we can give you to participate. We want to give you one. We want you to understand it. We want you to take it and run with it. Amen.
Amen.
And be blessed. Amen. Watch what God does. Because we're not sprinters. As it were. We're long distance runners. You listening to me?
Yes.
There's a saying in Africa. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Hey? Eh?
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Want to go fast or far?
Far.
You decide. Then let's get together. Let's get together.
Yes.
We've sat in the council chambers with the Lord. We've heard a strategy from heaven. Father's given us a divine strategy. And we will pursue it. And we will go. Though none go with us, we will follow. And we want everybody to come. The Lord wants everybody to be a part of the kingdom. He wants everybody to be involved. He doesn't want to leave anybody out. He doesn't choose to leave anyone out. Every person decides what they're going to do with their life. Do not be left Yeah. So little Bubba got healed, huh? The other night?
Yes.
Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
How's everybody doing tonight? Isn't God good?
Yeah.
Mike, where's Mike? Where's Mike at? Mike told me he injured his rib, and he came out to get prayer, and he started walking towards up here, and he immediately got healed. Shocking. Sometimes there's a slow process in healing, as it were. It's like there's hindrances, like there's whatever's going on. Don't worry about it. Done deal. Huh? Knock it out of your way and run right through the troop. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. God's real. His word works. All we got to do is get involved. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be blessed and happy, because there's no way to see change come in your house other than just letting the power of God surge through you. Get all frustrated about things and you're going to make it worse. Huh? Are you hearing what I'm telling you? I speak healing to your body right now in Jesus' name, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, refreshing to your spirit. I command you to be filled with the Spirit. Be strengthened by the Holy Ghost in your inner being. Amen. Why? So that you can be rooted and grounded in love. Product. Now you know why you got strengthened. Some people just say, no, strengthen me. They don't even know what they're getting strengthened to do. Hallelujah. Come on. Isn't that just crazy of us? Don't we act silly sometimes? Oh, strengthen me, Lord. Don't even know what we're going to do with the strength that we got. Just looking around. He strengthens us by the Spirit. Amen. So that we can be rooted and grounded in love. Amen. And there being rooted and grounded in love, be able to comprehend with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the breadth, the length, the depth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To know the love of Christ. Woo! Got to be rooted and grounded in love to know the love that passes knowledge. Hallelujah. And there be filled with all the fullness of God. Hallelujah. The basis of his always love. The basis of all that God is going to do is his love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Amen. 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 Yes. Amen. Amen. Eager. Willing and obedient. Willing and obedient. Willing and obedient. Thank you, Jesus. I speak peace and rest to your mind now in Jesus' name. I speak peace and rest to your spirit right now in Jesus' name. I speak peace and rest to you now. We can be so busy trying to figure out those things that we're supposed to do in God that become overwhelmed by it, really kept from what his purpose for us to do. Just rest, get quiet, just rejoice, just relax. In Jesus' name, just crawl out from underneath the pressure. I command it in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The Lord says, come unto me, all ye that are labored and heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon yourself and learn how it is with me. For I am meek and lowly. I'm under the mandate of heaven. I live to do the will of the Father. I'm not doing my own thing or championing my own ideas. I don't need to be my own defender, my own protector, my own provider. I'm under the rule, the mandate of heaven. I'm meek and lowly. Here in this place, you shall find rest unto your souls. You shall relax. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. You don't need to leave here tonight with confusion, frustration, problems, issues, because God, the Holy Ghost, is here. He just wants you to settle it all with Him. Make all those things, take all those things that you've made important that are not important at all, shove them out of the way. Write them down on a piece of paper, wad them up, throw them in the trash can, and walk away. Amen.
Amen.
Say, Lord, I live for you to do thy will, O God. Say,
Lord,
I will do anything.
I will do anything.
Your assignment's easy now. God can speak now. The only wrestling with God's will is, I want to do this. And the Lord's not releasing you or giving you the ability to do that. Now you're like, I don't know what the will of God is. Oh, yeah, you do. You just don't listen. Just say, Lord, I do anything. And then you just start doing whatever's set before you. Just do it. And you do it with joy. You do it with rejoicing. And then God takes you, and He will begin to cause you to grow, mature. And as you're responsible and faithful in little things, He'll make you ruler over much. He'll increase it. Hallelujah. As you're faithful with the unrighteous mammon, He commits to you true riches, unsearchable riches, true riches, the riches of the Spirit, the riches of heaven, the riches of divine authority. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, we love you guys, every one of you. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.